everything that I know. Says I gotta go, tired of going solo. But I'm never gonna go there again. This is what it is, this is who I am. This is where I finally take my stand. I didn't wanna fall, but I don't have to crawl. I'm not the one with two scarred hands. Giving him the best of everything that's left of the life inside this man. I've been born again.
Ready on the right,
I'm ready
on the left. Already on the firing line. That's what they used to tell us when I was in ROTC. This was in high school. It was just to let everybody know, duck and cover, because we're getting ready to shoot. And on the rifle range, that's what they say. Ready on the right, ready on the left, already on the firing line. No, I'm not afraid. I'll tell them, ready. Are you ready on the left? Because here we come. This is fresh black coffee.
All the truth in black and white.
In black and white. Like it or not. Hey, Dave, I've got to tell you, as you adjust things. Yeah, there he goes. Uh-oh. Yeah, okay, now we're back. I've been really having fun on X this week.
Have you been expressing?
Yes, I've been expressing my... Express yourself. Oh, by the way, for those of you that haven't experienced X yet, Twitter this week changed over to X.
Yeah.
Now, it's weird. I go on Twitter on my computer and on the phone. On the phone, it's still Twitter.
Oh.
On my computer, on my laptop, it's X.
Hmm.
It's a totally... In fact, if you... I don't know how many of you are on X or Twitter, TwitX. Mm-hmm. Anyway, if you have the X website, it looks like Facebook. It's totally different. I mean, and it has so much more. It's got like, you know, videos and pictures and sidebars and... It's like open a whole new world. It's you know, Elon and company, they've really gone after it.
Yeah.
So go get him, Elon. I mean, he says, what does he call Zuckerberg? He calls him something boy. Yeah. No, I can't what he calls it. In fact, there's an Elon Musk parody account.
Yeah.
On Twitter. Have you seen it?
Yeah, we talked about
it. Oh, did we talk about
it? Yeah.
And I don't know who does it, but it's identical. I mean, you know, it uses his... I wonder if it's not... I think it's really him.
We talked about it a few weeks ago, because I actually think it's a brilliant move where he can claim, that wasn't me, that wasn't my account. And I actually think he's probably got a bunch of consultants, including Babylon Bee.
That's exactly I remember now. We did talk about it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a because some of the stuff, it's just too good for like anybody, you know, sitting at home just to come up with some of this stuff. Mm-hmm. It's really funny, the things they come up with, but it really does sound like some Babylon Bee stuff. But anyway, no, it is really, it's very different. It's so weird because it just says X. That's all it says, you know, instead of Twitter with the little bird.
Right.
It's just an X.
Yeah.
So if you haven't checked it out, and listen, by the way, if you are disappointed in Facebook and want to check it out, go sign up. Now, there's this deal where you can pay, what is it, $5 a month, I think, for, you can pay $5 a month to Twitter to have a bona fide account.
Right.
A registered account. But you don't have to get it's a check mark. You get your little check mark. I don't have that. Now the only difference with that I've seen is, I'm still limited to, what is it, 110 characters or 220?
Well, it used to be 144. They 144. Bumped it to 288 like 3-4 years ago.
Okay, so, which is still limiting to me.
Mm-hmm.
But I've learned how to do the shorthand. So, but anyway, you ought to see my stuff. I mean, you know, I take the E's off all my the's, so it's all TH. And, you know, people understand what I'm saying, getting the point across. But a lot of, you know, Democrats, idiots, don't, they think I can't spell or can't write words, but it, you know, they understand what I'm saying. Anyway, but
it's the new shorthand.
It's a new it's Twitter shorthand.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, I can't write my treaties.
Yeah. Well,
treatises. Treatises. There you go. Treatises.
Now, I got to say, back in 2016, George Will, you know, the famous columnist who hates Donald Trump.
Oh, he
had a zinger one day on Fox News Sunday. He said, I don't use Twitter. Unlike Donald Trump, I can't say everything I know on a subject in 144 characters.
He should keep it to 140 because neither can anybody else. And honestly, nobody really cares.
I know. It was when's just the last he was calling Trump a simpleton.
Oh, I know. When's the last time you heard from George Will?
Oh, yeah.
Exactly. That's how important George Will is.
I have to say, George Will was hated by Bush Sr., too.
Oh, yeah.
He was on the outs there.
Oh, he was despicable. I mean, really despicable. But you know who else is really bad? I mean, I can't believe how bad. He's worse than Mitt Romney, worse than... Liz Cheney.
He's building up the suspense here.
Yeah, Bill Kristol.
Oh, God.
You see? He agrees. Yeah. The latest thing, he's on Twitter, and this, he's worse than any Democrat, the stuff he's writing and saying. I mean, you talk about a turncoat. There's no center. He doesn't say anything. He says nothing. Other than to attack Donald Trump.
Yep.
It's Donald Trump has so badly damaged him that that's all, it's just, he's vindictive towards Donald Trump. That's his whole, he's overtaken his entire mind. Yes. He owns his mind. It's like he's riding.
That's what the term Trump derangement syndrome means.
It truly, Bill Kristol is the prime example of Trump derangement syndrome. He has driven Bill Kristol totally mad. I mean, it's unbelievable stuff. But Bill Kristol is now totally irrelevant. You see him nowhere.
Listen, conservatives never quote him. If you see him quoted, that'll tell you about the media sites you're looking to.
I think the only place you may have seen him would be either MSNBC or CNN. You will not see him on any conservative outlet at all. But anyway, X, getting back to X, Twitter, whatever.
Yeah.
It's really, they changed, I think it was Thursday, Wednesday or Thursday, they officially changed over to the new symbols, new site. Now, for some reason, like I said, I think you have to totally delete it on your phone, or you have to do something to get it to change. And
That's what I think's happened here, because you and I may not have even reset our phones, and mine still says Twitter and still has the blue bird.
Yeah,
but it works just the same.
Oh yeah, it works the same, and it looks the same. But then when I went online on my computer.
Yeah.
On my laptop, it was totally different. And it's nice. I like it a lot. So anyway, I'm happy for Elon that it's doing well. Oh, by the way, what's the portion of the competitor that Facebook?
Oh, they're Threads?
Threads.
Yeah.
Was it you telling me last week that it fell 40%?
It dropped to only 40% of what it was, and maybe even worse than that. I mean, it's not ready. The difficulty there, you know, is Mark Zuckerberg, who started Facebook, now called Meta, or the parent company's Meta, and bought out Instagram and WhatsApp, I think he owns that too. they started a separate entity, but you needed an Instagram account in order to use it. And instead of just expanding Facebook to that feature, you know, so.
Yeah, and Instagram to me is like for scrapbookers. I mean, it's like scrapbooking.
Yeah, it's Instagram? Not even as good as Pinterest is a good scrapbooking.
Right.
Yeah, Instagram is look at me. You know, it's just look at me, you know, and follow my life, my every move.
Did we talk about this, the commercial way back?
With that one guy was like, yeah.
I am sitting on my
You know
patio.
What? And I'm sorry, I did not patch that on to the end of last week's show. It is hilarious. Oh. It's about boomers.
Yeah,
trying to be cool on social media, and their kids going, no.
Yeah, the kids are coming out, and their parents won't talk to them because they're busy on their phones, you know.
Yeah.
Just, I am sitting on my patio. I am drinking a beer.
Well, and you know what? To be honest, 10, 15 years ago, that's kind of what people were doing
right on
it. And I think the funny thing is when your parents do it, it exposes how ridiculous it is because nobody cares that your parents just add a prune juice.
It's awful. I have to tell you, and I've seen the worst of it. I used to run sound at my church,
and
we have a light person. So one Sunday they had this young girl come in. Mm-hmm. Never seen her before, but I guess she was the stand-in sub light person.
Lighting.
Lighting. Okay. She ran the stage lighting.
Okay, I thought meant she was skinny and petite. I didn't know. Light person. I don't know. Oh.
As in the heavy.
Or light colored. I don't know.
As opposed to the heavy person, right?
I don't know.
We had a substitute heavy person.
All right. Now,
you get it?
Yeah.
The lighting person. Okay.
There you go.
So anyway, so the whole service, I'm looking over. She's next to me, and I'm looking over. And this is no joke. This was the girl.
Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
Listen. This is during during worship, and then she would change the lighting, hit it, and then.
Oh, God.
And then she'd look at him, delete, and then go back to. And I'm thinking, for an entire hour, this girl is sitting there.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to just. I was thinking, are you kidding me? This was as bad as the lady that I got in trouble on Facebook. Remember, I've talked about this probably too much, with the giant Yeti cup this big in one hand during worship.
Oh, yeah. Put your drink down, lady.
Yeah, put your drink. You know, and I got attacked because I'm the judgmental one. You know, and I so badly, you know, talk about Babylon Bee doing a spoof. I so badly wanted to one Sunday come in with a Coors can or a big bottle of beer or something, or a fifth of Jack Daniels like this and wait for somebody to say something, you know.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, honestly, if you're gonna have something in your hand, what's the difference?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if God doesn't care, at least it's good that she's there. You know, at least she's there worshiping. Yeah, I'm there worshiping too. You know, who cares that I've got a fifth of Jack Daniels in my hand? You know, or I've got a joint. You know, this is my sacrifice of praise to you, God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean.
Oh, maybe she's sharing with God. God, this coffee's so good. You want a drink? I don't know. It's your Yeti cup.
Well, I've got a better one.
Mm-hmm.
Offering up that sweet incense.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Dave, we better quit before we get it. We're going to get some response to that this week. If you have any problems with anything we're sharing, his name is Dave Van Risingham. send it to Dave Van Risingham@freshblackcoffee.com.
See, I think I'm getting my payback. Last week, I was all over Eddie. I was badgering and stuff, and I said, I got scorpion venom in my veins, you know, which I did, and because I got stung the day before. But now Eddie, oh, my God, Somebody gave him too much caffeine. Does your wife not monitor? Oh, that's right. She's out of town.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
why. Hey, I brought it with me. I've got the big, cool. It's not Yeti cup. It's some brand X or something. But I made coffee, very strong Ugandan coffee, by the way. Ugandan mist. And Coke.
Oh, you mixed it.
Coke Zero, yeah. Ooh. I mixed my own. Remember, I used to buy it for some reason, not Quick Trip, but Coca-Cola quit making that. I guess it wasn't as, it was only popular with me, the weird outcast. Maybe I liked it. Maybe I liked the mixture because I'm mixed. I'm a mixture. That's probably why I liked it so much. But anyway, I made my own, so I brought it with me.
So the guys at the tavern order a Windsor Coke. You order a Uganda Coke.
Yeah. Put a little bit of umbrara in it. Yeah. Just a touch of umbrara or Kigali.
Or as Julie Childs, I said, I like mine with a little white wine or vermouth.
People are going to think we're high. Yeah. They're going to say I wasn't faking it.
Hey, I don't have my medical card. Do you?
No, okay. No. Well, me. I'm the one who's opposed to it. You're the one who's for it. Hey, let's move on. Hey, no, seriously, check out Twitter, or X, as it's called.
Yes.
It's really interesting. And if it hasn't changed on your phone, check it out on a laptop or on your computer, and you'll see what X actually looks like. Mm-hmm. In fact, Dave can do it. Mm-hmm. But also in the news, hey, Colorado has officially decided to join the Big 12.
University of Colorado.
University of the Buffalo.
Now we know it's important in Eddie's life, okay? Big 12 sports.
Big 12 sports.
Hey, the former wide receiver for Texas Tech.
Well, anyway.
You got the four-year deal, didn't you?
No.
I thought you got it.
I quit my freshman year.
But weren't you offered it to begin with?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. No, it's too long a story. Okay. You're interrupting. Dave always wants to either lift me up higher than I belong or tear me down lower. But anyway, no.
And they both are effective.
It's a long story. It's a long story.
Yeah. But you were originally part of the team.
Yes, the freshman team.
Yeah.
Right. That was back before, in 1969, that whole 69-70 season, they still had freshman football.
Oh.
Yeah, freshmen could not play legally. They would not let freshmen play until you were a sophomore.
Now it's all about the
money. It was the next year that was the first year freshmen could play varsity.
Okay.
In college football.
It's almost like redshirt.
And it was the year Archie Griffin came along and won the Heisman Trophy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, as a freshman. He's the only, he's won it twice. And a couple of other freshmen have won it since. But Archie Griffin was the first, and he won it twice. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to get sidetracked. Colorado Buffalo have rejoined the Big 12.
Well, they voted to. I don't think we got the original, the official contract signed.
Well, yeah. Mm-hmm. Will you let me finish my story? I'm going to start nitpicking yours every
There's
time you talk.
There's still scorpion venom in me.
I guess.
Yeah.
But anyway, one reason I'm excited. Oh, and Colorado this year is playing against, I think, do they play OU? I know. I'm trying to remember the first game. Oh, they play TCU. They play TCU in September.
Yes.
Yeah.
As a non-conference.
Right. Yeah, it'll still be non-conference, but it should be interesting.
That will be what we gauge Deion on.
Especially, with their stellar record last year.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be really good.
Yeah, but he's saying that tongue in cheek because Colorado stunk.
No, I'm talking about TCU.
Oh, right. TCU was...
went to the national championship. Oh, no, I'm talking about TCU's stellar record.
Yeah.
But I'm really excited to see what Deion Sanders can bring, if he's going to make a difference in Colorado, because Colorado has, let's face it, not been very good.
And his boy is the quarterback.
Right.
Right? So,
who he brought with him from...
Yeah, he brought both his boys.
Oh, I didn't know
he's got two sons.
Oh, yeah, two?
Yeah.
Okay.
And they are good. I've seen them in person. They played here in Broken Arrow a few years back in high school.
There's a big stink about that, too. He's seen as a traitor for leaving Jackson State. Jackson State's Mississippi... historically black college, university, and it's a mess. They feel slighted, but honestly speaking, Dion basically outed them as some money shenanigans.
Oh, there was.
Oh, I know. That's what
I'm saying. And you know what? I have to say, just on that, I want to break up your thought, but if the black coach, Deion Sanders, did not take the big offer for the big league, blacks could have easily criticized him for not stepping up. You can't win with some of these folks.
No.
Especially the race baiters, the ones where it's everything about race and always will be. It, you know, look, I think they're just jealous.
Deion suffers from not Trump derangement, it's Trump similarities syndrome, TSS, not TDS, but TSS. He's very similar to Donald Trump. He is comfortable with who he is, and he's comfortable in letting you know he's comfortable. You know, he doesn't, in fact, I don't know if you know, he's had some real blood issues.
Yeah, blood clots surgery, a lot of blood clots, week.
Right. And apparently they've removed a lot of them. Now, I wonder if he was vaccinated. That would be another whole story.
That's a good
if
point.
The clot, because they're removing a whole, apparently they removed a lot of clots. And if they're removing that many and they're stuck in, it was those long, you know, was, you've
yeah,
seen
two
those.
Two places, his upper and lower leg. Yeah.
Right. And so if it takes surgery to remove, because clots usually, like I've had them. I had four in that hit my right lung and two in my left lung.
Ooh, it can kill you.
Oh, yeah. My doctor told me I was inches from death. I could have suddenly died if it hit my heart or my brain. And it was a miracle that I didn't, that I caught it when I did, or I would have died.
Yeah.
But anyway, so for them to reside in his leg like that, for them to have to take them surgically, remove the clots, it was something. But anyway, I will be interested to see. I wish Deion well. I have to say, I don't necessarily like Deion's personality. And honestly, I mean, this is crazy, okay? I know some people won't understand this. I don't really like Donald Trump's personality. I don't think you do either, right? I mean, I don't think...
Oh, yeah, there's a number of things are grating.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. Yeah. Like you'll say, oh my God, why? Por qué, Donald? Por qué? Why did you have to say that? Why did you? Because it doesn't make sense to me. But it is who they are.
Yeah.
You know? And so that's how it is with Deion Sanders. There's a lot of things he says, you know? But I've come to the realization that the one thing I have to give both of these men, Donald Trump and Deion Sanders, is they are two of the most honest people that you will meet. What you see is what you get.
Yeah. And positivity.
Yeah.
Really positive.
They believe in themselves and whatever they're doing.
Yeah. And I want to say, you know, on the media level, it can come across a certain way. And people have said that who have talked to Trump privately, they say he's so engaging, he's so friendly, he really is a people person. He only comes across with that obnoxiousness in his media. And you know, when I was out watching a homeschool team from Missouri playing Deion's high school team when he was coaching his boys, he took time to go over afterwards and talk to the kids on the other team and point out, hey, number 43, that was an awesome sack in the second quarter. You know, building him up. You know, Tom, building up other people. You know, I'm sorry, a narcissist doesn't do that.
Yeah, I've heard a story about Donald Trump going across the Manhattan or Brooklyn Bridge, and the guy was getting ready to commit suicide, and he has the guy stop, pull over, and talks to the guy. Just talk to the guy now.
Yeah.
And the guy was so blown away, and Donald Trump stops. You know, not, it wasn't just some guy or cop trying to talk to him. This was Donald Trump taking time to stop and talk to the guy and save the guy's life. It's, he says, what are you, you know, what are you doing? You know, or there was a, the old, one of the security guys at the, Madison Square Garden. And he's, he wasn't there one day, and he ran into his son. He said, "Where's your dad?" And he said, "Oh, he's not feeling well. He's this and this." And Donald then, you know, made a special trip to visit the guy. I mean, these are all of the things. What does the Bible say? Mm-hmm. Let your giving be done in secret.
Yeah.
Right? That nobody knows about it. That he would go do all of these things for people, give to people and do this and that for these people without people knowing about it. These are stories that come up later that you don't know who he gave to, whatever. And I think Dion is that way as well. He yeah. doesn't have to, you know, the persona, the person you see these braggadocious, you know, the guy dancing after an interception and talking big talk, but their private lives, they're not perfect. I think Dion has some women issues as well as Trump or has had.
Okay.
And, you know, we are but men. Mm-hmm. They are but men.
Yeah.
You go through Kings and Chronicles. Mm-hmm. There are some kings.
Yeah. King, hey, I wouldn't trust King David around my wife. I've said that before. You've said that.
Well, listen, he's not the only one.
I know.
I mean, there's a few other kings, you know, and... You know, and there's a whole lot of presidents that we've had, but Donald Trump is the guy. You know, that's the other thing that's so funny.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about it, Donald Trump,
yeah,
everybody is so down on him. And listen, I'm not recommending his lifestyle, his prior lifestyle, as a model lifestyle, okay?
Yeah.
People have to understand that. But yet at the same time, especially the Democrats, they need to stop. They just need to stop. But if you look at the lives of prior presidents, you look at John F. Kennedy, the stories of Dwight David Eisenhower, and the difference in LBJ. I mean, my goodness, the stories I've heard about Lyndon Johnson are just horrendous stuff.
It's that sense of entitlement that comes with power. Power, what did Kissinger said? Power is the ultimate aphrodisiac.
Well, yeah, that and the Delilah. You've got the Delilah syndrome, too. You know, listen, there's women out there after your sons.
That's true. Yeah, there people are attracted to power. Women will throw themselves
women,
at
women, I mean, you know, I mean, listen, mothers, guard your sons.
Yeah. Well, that's why you've been, you know, as a music industry person, you were so impressed with Stryper. With all of the trappings of fame, and these were devoted men who avoided any women when they were on the road, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I was shocked. And they got in trouble because apparently they had some... The story came out that, you know, they had a girl or girl come into the dressing room, but nothing ever happened. I mean, you know, that happens all the time.
Oh,
you know? The other one I remember reading about that I was really impressed with, not even a Christian band, but Foreigner.
Mm-hmm.
Foreigner. Foreigner would not allow any women on the bus. Mm-hmm. They didn't drink.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is, you know... one of the biggest rock bands of the 80s, Foreigner, you know, Hot-Blooded, you know, it sounds like Hot-Blooded. And you have this, and then again, you have some of your holy.
Jim Baker?
High and lift up. Well, I'm talking music groups.
Oh, okay.
Christian artists.
Yeah.
And, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So. You know, like I think we've had the conversation about what they did to Stryper, what they did to Michael English. Michael English is another one.
Mm-hmm.
That to me is one of the most tragic stories. What happened to Michael English? You know, here you got a guy tragically handsome, brutally handsome, the Eagles would say, brutally handsome. But anyway, and unbelievable voice.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, a guy just, you know, and he stumbles and falls in the Christian artist or the Christian music scene wants to kick him to the side. Yet you have another certain artist with a certain label, a bigger label or a bigger surrounding, better management or more important management, and we're ready to look the other way.
Yeah, money at stake. Yep. And by the way, about Michael English, I remember I took my wife and kids on an East Coast road trip right maybe 6 months after the whole thing with Michael English, the scandal and all that. And I think we were in West Virginia. We stopped at a truck stop, and I'm waiting for Debbie to get back in the car, you know. And she comes, she says, "I just talked to Michael English." And I go, and I see a tour bus, and I said, "Is that the guy that was with that teenage girl?" He said, "That's his daughter." She said, "He's the nicest guy, and he's with his family, and they're just, you know." And it's, you know.
and you were picturing this guy with horns and a tail. Well,
and you see where scandals can come from.
It just blows up.
You know, what's a 40-year-old guy with an 18-year-old girl? What's his daughter? Hello?
Yeah. You know? Well, see, that's the thing. In the Christian, they just tossed him like a piece of garbage.
Yeah.
And they pulled all of his music from the stores. Same with Stripe. Remember, they Christian, they pulled all of their music from the Christian stores. You know, the other artists, they never did that.
Yeah.
You know, and they wrote such horrible, you know, bad things about him. The guy ends up, you know, falling away temporarily. You know, I mean,
you can get bitter.
You want to just turn your, but I'm convinced that when God has you, he'll bring you back.
Yeah.
You'll understand. Yeah. Man, that's about to make you cry. But he's still got you. And you'll eventually realize, wait a minute, it's not about me and you, God. The issue is with me and them.
Yeah.
And I want to come back to you. Will you have me back?
Yeah.
I'm sorry for what I did. Because God is ready. This is our preaching moment, I guess, by the way. But God will always take you back. You know, that's the biggest trick of the devil, to make you think that you've blown it and you can't come back.
Yeah. And by the way, talk about, you know, keeping a positive attitude, not bitter. What Michael English did, and this came out in an article later, wasn't it part of my wife's discussion with him, is that the people of the lower and mid Appalachian states knew him. And he just went back to traveling ministry, reaching out to them because they knew him. You know, if the big, you know, moguls in Nashville decide to cut you off from your national outreach, you go a different direction, you know, and you just keep going. Because what does God call us to do? It's to be faithful. The results are up to him. You know, the master who, when he comes back, finds his servant faithful. Right. That is who the master commends.
Yeah.
You know, and hey, by the way,
I was just going to say, for those that are wondering, who are we talking about? He started with Bill Gaither.
That's how we got to know him. Right. He was ministering in local churches before that.
Well, right. Yeah. But then Bill Gaither Band, and then he went on his own. The song that did it was Mary, Did You Know? His version. He had the original version of Mary, Did You Know? And, I mean, there's still a lot of have tried singing that, but no one has ever sung it better. If you want to get a chance, go to YouTube, go wherever, and look up Michael English, Mary, Did You Know?
Yeah.
I mean, his voice is unbelievable. Yeah. I mean, he's but like you said, the real person is different from what the media tries to pretend. But anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, about Donald Trump, when you mentioned the suicide, and I had not heard that story, but I do know Donald Trump lost family members to what either you could outright call suicide or drinking themselves to death.
Yeah, his brother, Fred.
Exactly.
Fred Trump.
That's where I'm getting at. And when you lose somebody so, so important to you, and that it drives you all the more, how can I prevent the next guy down the road?
That's why he won't drink. He does not drink.
Bingo.
At all. He will not touch alcohol.
See, you know, you probably wouldn't have a medical card either, which I don't. I mean, I'm all for medicine for people who need it, says the teetotaler here. And I'm not for prohibition. Right. That's the same, you know, I'm like, if I'm going to be tough on liquor going back to prohibition, then I at least have some consistency when I say no to marijuana decriminalization. I just feel like, hey, let's, if they're both the same risk, treat them both the same. You know, now I'm not that way when it comes to meth or crack or things that will kill you that develop a, you know.
Yeah, I'm as a former lover and user. Yeah. A doper. As a former doper, I've just put it down.
A boy of the 70s,
a pothead, whatever you want to call us. I beg to differ a little bit. I think it's a little worse than that. But it was addictive. The only way I was able to kick it was through the miraculous deliverance from
there
Jesus.
You go.
But to me, I think it was a disingenuous argument, because if the medical marijuana people had been truly serious, what should have happened, they should have fought for it to be dispensed through your doctor and only through prescription by the doctor and dispensed at a pharmacy.
And
if it's truly a medical issue, mental or otherwise.
Right.
But the way it is now, basically, you just got head shops all over the place. You got the paraphernalia. Mm-hmm. Have you been into a dispensary?
Yes.
Okay. You've seen what they've got, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I went to one of the upscale ones in South Tulsa.
Well, that means they just have upscale pipes, bongs, and
classier display cases, you know, all that.
Oh, that makes it better. That makes it better.
I, you know, our friend Peggy, who's very much against it, I was kind of tweaking her a few weeks after it passed. I was speaking at a Tulsa 912 club, and I said, now, I know some of you live down where Peggy lives in the fancy part of town, you know, probably, you know, could do without it and probably won't have any shops. And Rhonda says, oh, no, her neighborhood will have the good stuff. Oh, Peggy was worked up. Rhonda and I were picking on her.
but seriously, if they were truly interested in meeting a medical need, then I say it's dispensed by true physicians and only for a true medical need. Mm-hmm. But when they went to the point where anybody could get a card, if you were able to convince somebody you had a need and you could grow 12 plants in your own home,
and this.
Now, all of a sudden, now they're trying to backtrack, rein it back in. Mm-hmm. It's very hard to do that.
Sure.
It's very hard to put the cat back in the
bag. I understand that. So I read a little bit on prohibition in Oklahoma, and it had two groups that really drove it. One was the religious folks, you know, the teetotalers, the, the other,
NIMBY.
Yeah.
Not in my neighborhood.
The others were the bootleggers. Yes, when you make it illegal.
Oh, no, I know.
Then it's the ruffians that have a monopoly, right? And I will say this. The war on drugs federally has been a just dismal failure. Dismal failure. Just like the war on poverty has been a dismal failure.
Yeah, but see, I've always said this. I said that back on the Pat Campbell show. Mm-hmm. The problem with the war on drugs, in my opinion, this is my humble opinion, is that we have never truly fought the war on drugs. If we had fought the war on drugs as they fight in Singapore, we wouldn't have a drug problem.
Yeah.
The war on drugs is like our war on abortion. Okay. And you agree with me on this one.
Okay.
but we disagree on the drug one. To me, on abortion, for example, I have stated that you cannot punish the physician without punishing the person who comes to the physician for the abortion. And I have people, which I want to bring that up here in a minute, that side with the woman that gets the abortion. They have all kinds of reason why you can't hold her responsible, but we want to jail the physician that provides the service mm-hmm. for, in my opinion, the murderer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
The person that brings the person for execution, the baby mm-hmm. for execution, but we're going to get the executioner.
Yeah. It's so, legal as long as you hire a hitman to do
it. Right. Exactly. So with the drug thing, I think if we were as tough on drugs in America as they are in Singapore, we would be like Singapore and not have a drug problem. In other places around the world where they have very strict drug rules, Turkey, Singapore, there are other places around where mm-hmm. they don't have the drug problem that we have because they are very, very strict on drugs.
Yeah, when Singapore becomes our solution, I'm sorry, I'm out of here. I just, you know.
Have you been to Singapore?
I'm talking about the principle of, hey, it's my life, okay? I don't want to live in a nanny state.
No, it ends up not being your life. It ends up not being your life because those people that end up on the drugs end up bleeding over and affecting those people who are not on the drugs. This has been the argument. We're going all the way back into the 40s and 50s.
Those were the same arguments used to keep prohibition in place.
And I think the arguments were right.
Really?
But see, here's the difference, okay? We arrest and we have laws on people being intoxicated on alcohol.
Intoxicated.
Right. Now, you tell me what laws we have for people being intoxicated on drugs.
Okay, no.
No, tell me what's the law for being intoxicated?
Well, I want to first of all clear it. The law is against public intoxication endangering the public like by getting behind a vehicle, right?
Okay, right.
And then the third thing is exploiting children, right? Okay, so, yeah, those
When's
laws
the last
are-
time you heard somebody being arrested for being high on drugs? Driving while under the influence of marijuana?
I don't know.
It's because they're not. Why? Do you know why? Hmm. And I got this from Steve Kunstwater. There is no gauge. They don't have so many milligrams.
It's called driving while impaired. And most of it is you got lazy cops
how do you know somebody's impaired?
We used to use field sobriety. Remember when you and I were kids? They didn't have breathalyzers.
How do you judge field sobriety against marijuana?
From a standpoint of how it endangers others, it's simple. Your coordination, your reaction time. You know, it's walking the line, touch your nose, all those things that they used to do when they pulled you over because you're swerving all over the road.
But that's only an early indicator. The only way they can truly get you on alcohol is through a breathalyzer or blood. Dave, they cannot get you. The only thing walking the line or whatever will do is give them a reason to maybe arrest you, but they cannot convict you or anything unless they can actually prove that you have a blood alcohol level of XYZ.
I understand.
Okay.
They added those statutes later once they got the technology to add those things. But before that, they used to bust people for driving all over the road.
I don't think so. I mean, they could get you for reckless driving. They get you for driving all over the road. But what I'm saying is, we have nothing right now. In fact, do you remember the young kid that got shot in Broken Arrow by the security guard at the apartments.
Yeah.
He was the 6'7" yeah. young kid. Mm-hmm. Okay. Tragic story because it never should have happened.
Mm-hmm.
That guy got off scot-free.
He did.
Scot-free. That was a terrible, terrible misjustice. Mm-hmm. They let that guy off the hook. That
was Kunzweiler.
It was Kunzweiler, right.
Mm-hmm.
And he even, I'm not going to go any further right now. But anyway, the guy had marijuana in his truck
mm-hmm.
with a firearm.
Yeah.
And they let him go.
Mm-hmm.
Let him move to, he just moved to Texas. Okay. Talk about miscarriage of justice. Mm-hmm. I mean, that guy should have been under the jail.
Mm-hmm.
Became a paraplegic.
And then died.
And then died. And do you know the insurance company would not pay the bill because they said it was in the commission of a crime, even though there was never any crime.
Right.
Really.
Yeah, you got to sue the insurance company on that.
Well, yeah, hopefully they did, but I think he had a bad lawyer, and I don't even think they mm-hmm. did that. I don't know. I probably need to follow up on that. But anyway, but basically, these are the type things, because the marijuana law are so flimsy, so weak, so bad.
Mm-hmm.
I just hate it. I think it's that, you know, you hear about the slippery slope.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is a cliff.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I don't like it. And I think a lot of what we're seeing in America today is a result of these Washington, Oregon, California. These were the first states to legalize marijuana.
Yeah.
And I think we're going to see the same effects end up coming. Everything we've seen there, you've seen Colorado okay. go liberal. I think eventually we're going to see Oklahoma go okay. the same way as those. And I think a part of it is when you legalize marijuana.
Okay. The vehicle by which these states legalized it share one thing in common, the early states, is they had initiative petition, the right of the people to circumvent the legislature. Because you and I were alluding to it early in our conversation about those who become invested in their livelihood, their careers, are based on keeping all of these restrictions in place, big government restrictions. The war on drugs is one of those. And so you're not going to get people to give up that power. And so the individual person says, you know what? I need it for my arthritis. I need it for my PTSD.
I don't think that's it. I think there are I've always said there's just two types of people who got this pushed through and got it passed. Those who want to use the drugs, and those who want to make money from those who use the drugs. That's who, and in the end, the money behind it won. That's what it was. Finally, in Oklahoma, they defeated this last bit of legislation because the people finally realized maybe we went too far and we don't want to go any further. No,
well, I'm going to just push back on that because those two categories you talk about, I am neither. I'm a teetotaler. I don't even drink beer like you do, you know? And here's the other thing.
How do you drink it? Upside down or do you drink it through a straw?
I don't. You know, and my point is, if you use this prohibition thing of, well, you know, people are going to be destroyed by it and crime will happen. Eddie, how many crimes you committed to support your beer addiction? You don't have a beer addiction.
I don't have a beer, right.
And I'm telling you, there are plenty of people that don't have a cannabis addiction.
No, I disagree. I could disagree. listen. Okay, how many people do you know that smoke marijuana?
Hundreds?
Okay. Introduce me to them.
Okay, someday we will.
Okay. And I want to find out how often they use it, and I want them to not use it for a month.
Okay. And will you abstain from liquor for a month, too?
Oh, I do it all the time.
Okay, good. See,
I do it all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll drink a beer, but I don't I don't keep beer at home, or I don't drink.
Yeah.
Go to the bar.
Right. Yeah. In the right occasion, it might be good with a meal or a glass of wine with your steak. Right.
I don't drink wine because it messes with my stomach.
Okay. There you go. You know, I'm just, everybody's got everything. Some people just take a shot of brandy to go to sleep at night.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Some people do, but you don't take, smoke marijuana to go to sleep at night.
Oh, I know a lot of people.
Or a shot. Do. Well, let's put it this way. You don't take a shot of marijuana. Let's put it that way.
No, I'm particularly know one guy. He's a very good friend. And he says, I finally sleep through the night. I said, so how do you? He said, I just smoke a joint and go to bed.
Just get some rest easy. I've got these little rest easy. No, melatonin.
This is a guy who's done everything.
Oh, come on. No, come on.
I can't name names.
No, I don't want you to name names.
But I know him personally. I've known him for over 10 years. Okay. And I've seen him now, having lost 100 pounds. In fact, last time I got together, I didn't even recognize him. And he's lost 100 pounds
because he's smoking marijuana.
If you knew his health condition.
Usually it's the other way around. You lose weight when you don't sleep, not losing weight because you do sleep.
No, there are some things that, keep in mind, pain was underneath all of it. Okay. When you are sleep deprived, right, your body will put on weight when you're sleep deprived. But anyway, it really came down to a pain thing. And Pat Campbell's mother, was she addicted? But she was taking it in an oil, THC, you know, because the opioids didn't work anymore.
Okay, right. But she was getting it from a doctor, THC oils from her doctor, correct? Because she lived in Pennsylvania.
It didn't come from a doctor. It's still the same thing because of the federal regulations. It's still dispensaries, and it's still a doctor's recommendation.
Right, but it was dispensed through a doctor.
No, a dispensary like in Oklahoma.
Where?
In Pennsylvania.
Does Pennsylvania have they legalized marijuana in Pennsylvania?
They still license dispensaries just like Oklahoma does.
Okay.
Okay. You can still buy all the different refined products that come from the cannabis plant.
Right.
And now in Minnesota, you know, there's different restrictions. Like Minnesota, it came from the legislature because they don't have initiative petition, but they set it up to make.
Let me ask you, in Pennsylvania, do they have, are their dispensaries head shops like they are in Oklahoma?
I don't know whether they sell the dried flower form, the raw form of the cannabis.
The weed.
Form. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and that was the one thing. They tried to get rid of it in Oklahoma. The attorney general told the health department, you don't have authority to make up laws.
Which attorney general?
It was Mike Hunter, because it was at the time, it had just passed, and they threw a bunch of poison pill administrative agency rules in. And, you know, so, the author, Chip Paul, I'm talking to him because he's going to the legislature, and they're trying to get workable framework to finish out the language in it.
Right.
And I told Chip, I said, our Alamo is home grow. Do not give up home grow. Do not even make that a bargaining chip, because you need to have the ability for the person, the empowerment, that they can grow their own medicine. Say, don't have to pay all the taxes. Don't have to go through all the rigmarole. They know what they're getting because they grew it for their own health's sake. And I know several people who are doing it.
Yeah, we're just going to always disagree. We'll have to redo this again down the road. Basically, you're just telling people grow your own weed and as you wish, and you've just opened a door.
It's Pandora's box, Eddie. Two things I'm adamant on as a libertarian is you do not endanger public safety, including driving too slow.
How do you not endanger public safety just by, if you look at Colorado statistics, ever since they have legalized marijuana, the traffic, I mean, statistically, their accidents are up.
I disagree. Their citations for impaired driving from cannabis have gone up because cannabis usage has gone up. But their overall traffic has, fatalities and accidents has not.
The one I read, it has gone up. So we're reading different stuff.
I know. You really, and this is the thing about media, you got to dig through and find out.
Well, wait a minute. But see, how do you think the media would like to report it? That marijuana use is bad or marijuana use is good? I'm gonna say I think the media would lean towards the marijuana use is good or it's not bad versus the other way around. So I'm gonna trust the other stats a little more than I did the other one. So it just depends.
Yeah. But I'll tell you, Eddie, and I back when I was in high school and I did smoke marijuana, I was driving so slow, my buddy got out of the car and was walking faster than I was driving.
The other thing I look at is the effect on children.
Exactly. That's my other point is, exploiting children. We have to protect our children.
Not exploiting children, just, in other words, the money spent on marijuana versus the money spent on the children.
Well, then you got to make... all liquor.
Okay, you always assume. This is to me. That's a fake argument. You just assume that people that are smoking marijuana, if you don't give them marijuana, they're going to drink. I don't buy that argument.
That's not it. I'm saying the same standard you apply to something that you disapprove of and you will not consume and you think it's irresponsible and is hurting your family budget. We can say that about going to a concert, Eddie.
Yeah, but it's not harmful, and we don't have a concert every day.
But your argument was that it was taking away from providing for the needs of your family.
Yes, yes.
And I'm saying anything you do that is just, going to Bell's Amusement Park. I mean, anything.
Come on. How many times are you going to go to Bell's Amusement Park? Usually you're going to take the kids with you, right?
I'm simply saying, Eddie, to use that standard... it's wrong on two accounts because you don't do it equally and you're playing nanny state.
No, it's different. It's different. You're assuming, you always want to bring up the argument that if you don't let them have weed, they're going to spend it on booze.
Okay.
And that's not a fair argument.
I'm not saying they're going to spend it on booze. I'm not. I'm saying if you aren't imposing those same rules on other vices, then you're being inconsistent.
Well,
that's the point I'm making.
I'm not opposed to putting stricter rules on alcohol.
Okay. Eddie, but, without naming names, I want to tell you one person I know makes well into six figures and occasionally, maybe twice a month, might consume cannabis. And are we going to enforce that justification on him that somehow, if he has, he's not providing for his children's needs, no, making well into six figures?
Okay, is there a reason for that person to consume cannabis twice a month?
That's his business, not mine.
Oh, then why don't we just let him consume heroin twice a month?
And again, I have...
Is that free? I mean, if it's his business...
Right. This you bring up a great point, Eddie. That is a very good point.
How about if he just wants in Holland, he wants to visit a prostitute twice a month. His wife is not satisfied.
Okay.
Let's go visit a prostitute.
But Eddie,
I mean, no, wait. You're a libertarian. Should prostitution be legalized?
I want to break this down for you, Eddie.
No, don't break it down. Answer my question. You're a libertarian.
Eddie, you asked me one question, you asked me another. Okay, which one are we talking about?
Answer the first one, then
there we
my
go.
Answer. Okay, go.
That's
ahead.
What I'm trying to do.
All right, then we're good.
You bring up a great point.
Okay.
And this is where the libertarian argument has its limits. Is if you see somebody destroying themselves, do you use law to protect him from himself? In many states, it's against the law to commit suicide. Well, how do you punish them once they've committed suicide? But you make it a law because the law's a teacher, amongst other things. And when somebody is destroying themselves, how do you protect themselves? I mean, This is why we have mental health intervention laws. And I think there is a valid point when you have a very substantial case that the evidence, our knowledge, our technology, everything says you're going to be dead the direction you're going in very short order. And I think that's true with things that are physically addictive to the point that heroin, meth, you know, other things, fentanyl. I think you got a great point there. And I think you have to protect people from themselves. Another thing I'm going to say, courts do for somebody who's tragically alcoholic is you work out sentencing deals that protect them from themselves. I think it's a valid point. Now, the second point you talked about, the analogy of, okay, what about the Holland laws on prostitution? That's another issue, too. Now, on one level, it's, are we imposing our religious moral values? Yes, we are. The other is we're looking at a vested interest in protecting the institution of the family, because we know kids suffer more than anyone from any breakdown of a marriage. But then do you impose the same laws on a 45-year-old widower, you know, that you do on the family man? It's a tough deal. And I do believe there are good libertarian principles that Thomas Jefferson supported, that I do too, when he says, what difference does it make to me whether my neighbor believes in one God or 20, because it neither breaks my leg nor picks my pocket. So I think you've got two litmus tests. Are they endangering you, or are they bringing your society to ruin? You know, so.
All right, and then I will finish this up by saying, I think the marijuana legalization is bringing our society to ruin.
There you go.
You don't, and we will choose to differ on that. I think it's
great debate. All right. And we do this about four times a year.
I know, so I'm just saying, it's not the end of it. It'll come up again. We'll revisit it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe next time it'll be when we propose legalizing prostitution in Oklahoma. That'll be the next one.
We started out talking about Colorado coming back to the Big 12, by the way.
It really?
That's where we got off the
man, tracks. We really chased the rabbit. That rabbit got loose on that one.
Yeah.
Hey, oh my goodness, that is a funny one. Listen, the Hunter Biden Joe, the big guy, probe has gotten interesting. And it's funny, every time they come up with something new, it gets hairier and deeper for Joe.
Yeah.
They bring new charges against Donald. I mean, it's getting so obvious now.
Yeah.
That Jack Smith, that's his name, isn't it? Jack Smith, the...
Right, the special prosecutor.
Yeah. Every time something new comes out on Joe Biden, or gets a little deeper and more obvious that they committed crimes basically in the past, all of a sudden Jack Smith brings a new charge, which is not really a new charge. It's just a rehash of the same thing. I mean, they just keep bringing up a new thing. But anyway, basically now the Senate, is wanting to probe. First, it's been Congress that's been all over this.
Now the House, the
Senate is calling for a probe of Hunter Biden's lawyers allegedly lying about their identity. You know this story? Okay, here, U.S. District Judge Mary Ellen Norica released an order this week threatening sanctions against Hunter Biden's lawyers after accusing Latham and Watkins lawyer Jessica Bengals of having misrepresented her identity and who she worked for in an attempt to improperly convince the clerk's office to remove a key document from an ongoing criminal tax case involving President Biden's son. Bengals called the clerk's office pretending to be associated with lawyers linked to the House Republican Ways and Means Committee, which has also been investigating Hunter Biden. The order said Hunter Biden's legal team said it was an unfortunate and unintentional miscommunication between a staff member at our firm and employees of the court. Ricketts called on courts in both New York and Washington, D.C., where Hunter Biden's lawyers are licensed to practice, to launch an ethics investigation into Bengals and lead attorney Christopher Clark. I write to you regarding the apparent unethical conduct of members of the New York State Bar and District of Columbus Bar. As you know, the cornerstone of the legal profession is ethics. All legal professionals, lawyers and non-lawyers alike, are expected to maintain strict standards for the protection of colleagues, clients, and the court. I'm asking you, asking both the New York Department of Disciplinary Committee for the First Department and the District of Columbia's office to take swift action to examine the actions of attorneys Christopher Clark and Jessica Bengals. So apparently what they did, they tried to call the court clerk and get them to remove a certain charge and from the case that's coming before it to basically remove that in this case against Hunter Biden. But to do that,
It wasn't a charge. It was a
piece of evidence.
Amicus brief. It was the House of Representatives saying, hey, Judge, this is coming. We want you to know what our investigation is doing. And it was meant to throw cold water on this. And it was pretty powerful.
But
and,
it was a document. It was a piece of evidence.
But it was evidence that was going to come from a third party.
Right.
Yeah. And you're right. These attorneys working for other attorneys on behalf of Biden.
It was Biden's attorneys pretending that they were the attorneys for the House, which basically is fraud.
It is.
It's fraud. And to me, there's no other explanation. She just basically lied and tried to deceive. It should be an open and shut deal.
Yeah, it should. The problem is you're leaving it up to the Bar Association, which is not government.
Where?
Well, they're talking to New York
and
D.C.
Exactly.
And, in Delaware.
And you know what's going to happen.
Yeah, they're so leftist, number one. And number two, they aren't government. They're a club.
Exactly.
They're a guild. Yeah.
That hates Donald Trump.
Yes. What I'm wondering is, doesn't this become a contempt of court charge?
Yeah.
Where the judge issues sanctions, not against the associate attorney that made the phone call, but the attorneys actually representing Hunter in the court, the named representatives, under the guise of they directed her to.
Right.
You know, and if you're the woman attorney that made that, you know, fraudulent call
on behalf of,
yeah, you better make sure that you've got documentation to show that you weren't acting on your own. You were ordered to do that on behalf of named counsel.
Or we take away your legal.
Yeah. Because if we can throw those named attorneys that were at the court with Hunter last Thursday and throw them in the slammer or some kind of a fine or whatever tools our federal courts have, that to me is the right way. I do not believe in leaving it up to a private guild, occupational guild such as the Bar Association.
Oh, I agree.
To do these things.
No, I agree. And to me, there's no probe necessary. I mean, we know it happened.
Right.
I mean, we can say alleged, but basically, either she called and lied or she didn't.
Right. And a court can do this when the actual infraction happens in front of the court itself. Because then there's, you know, so I don't know. I mean, this is a weakness in our system. And I am a big, big opponent of the Bar Association having an exclusive right to decide who's an attorney, number one, and who gets recommended for a judgeship.
Right. And also where this is basically being brought, New York and D.C.
Yeah. I mean,
this is, you know, it's right. ridiculous.
That's... But it was interstate, right? So it is a federal issue. It is an interstate commission of a crime.
Oh, yeah.
And I have to call this a crime. It's a fraud. It's lying to the courts.
Totally.
It's
100%.
In fact, yeah. So, and listen, that document that she tried to have removed was a powerful document. And yeah. I think that it's probably the reason why this thing blew up is because the judges say, you know what? Who's representing the people here? Because the prosecution, who normally wants to throw the book at you, are all employees of the defendant's dad. And the funny thing I heard in the media Friday morning, you can't punish a man for loving his son. Well, yeah, think about that. Think of every crime where the parents help hide evidence, but you can't punish them for loving their son.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. That's the Breakfast Club, as I like to call them, the ladies on The View.
Yeah.
That's their, Whoopi Goldberg. All he did is love his son. You can't love your son too much. Yeah, right. Whoopi.
It's talking points.
Yeah.
And they were all spinning the same thing.
But Trump and his kids, you know, it's just, they're worthless. You know, they're crooks. He's defending his kids and they're all, you know, right, come on. These people are despicable. It's ridiculous. Hey, Oliver Stone.
Hmm.
He was on... the podcast with Russell Brand.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And he was on there, and he's, by the way, Russell Brand's show is called Stay Free.
Yes.
His podcast.
Yes. And he does it from England.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I didn't realize.
Yeah, actually, Tucker was on a few weeks ago. He flew to England.
Oh, okay.
And arranged it while he was kind of on a family vacation time.
Wow. That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, but he says that he made a mistake when he voted for Biden. He says that Biden may start World War III.
Mm-hmm.
He said, if we don't stop this, what Biden is doing, this guy is, he said, and I voted for him, I made a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking he was an old man now and he would calm down, that he would be more mellow and so forth. I didn't see it at all, he said. I see a man who maybe is not in charge of his own administration.
Right.
Who knows? So that's what he's afraid of. He's really, really worried, though. He said, everyone but us. Oh, and this is me now. Oh, yeah. Okay. I've got another one related to an extent. So if he's worried about that.
Before we go on to another topic, we talked about in a previous topic earlier today about the power of the administration and the trappings and people who are against getting rid of something because they made their career out of the status quo. There is no entity that isn't as big as the military industrial complex.
There it is.
Second being the pharmaceutical industrial complex now. But I think what it shows to me is how much Biden is beholden to the military-industrial complex, because there's a codependency. Nothing helps an incumbent win another term, like a war.
Yeah.
It unifies the people, you know.
Or lose, an incumbent lose as well, like Vietnam. Vietnam really cost the Democrats in 68.
But it really depends on how they see that war. If it's essential to protecting ourselves, our freedom.
But I think it's changed. I think the tide is turning. For example, Stone says here, he says he did a documentary, mm-hmm. Ukraine on Fire.
Okay.
The documentary is described as one that details the ousting of Ukrainian Viktor Yanukovych in a coup back in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
And he explains the origins of the current war raging in Eastern Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And he basically says that Ukraine is not innocent. He's one of those people.
Yes. Yes.
He's one of these people that yep. realizes he sees the other side.
Right.
That he says basically that He warned that unless the United States changes its suicidal course, it faces potential World War III.
And this is the biggest misnomer people have. And in America, we tend to want to, in any conflict, deem one side as good and the other bad. And a year and a half ago when this thing started, I was working on a house project, getting a house ready for someone, and a plumber come in. And I got to talking to him, find out he's just came over from Russia. He's actually an immigrant here. And I said, this conflict with Russia and Ukraine, I said, are there any good guys in it? He said, no. They're both bad. And here's where I want to go with your deal. I remember 2014 and that whole thing. I saw how corrupt the person in power was. So I assumed the movement to have him ousted was good. You see what happens is when you got one cartel ousting another because they're evil, yes, but are you any less evil? And we won't know until we give you power.
Right. What we have here, this is almost a reverse situation of what we had before. You remember Kosovo, which, by the way, that's flaring up again under the radar. A lot of people don't know. But
the former Yugoslavia.
Former Yugoslavia or portion of it down there. With the Albanians, but that's another whole story. Mm-hmm. But so you've got this eastern portion of Ukraine, the Donbass, that basically the Russian, it had a bunch of Russians that have inhabited, and they're essentially Russian people. I mean, they're Russian. Historically Russians, and they've moved in and they basically consider themselves Russian and they want to identify as Russians. Well, the Ukrainians say, no, you're not Russian. We want to be, you're Ukrainian. So you cannot be independent. They want to be independent. Ukrainians say you can't be independent. Mm-hmm. And all it would do, honestly, a lot of people don't understand this. If you follow the border, like up at the, it would just keep drawing the line down. And the thing that makes it a little weird is that you've got the Black Sea there. Is it the Black Sea or the Caspian Sea?
Black Sea.
The Black Sea that stops where the border stops up here. The Caspian Sea, I'm sorry, the Black Sea starts. But if you just follow that around, that would all be the Russian part.
Well, yeah, much like, should we say South Texas and South Arizona is part of Mexico because they're Hispanic and they speak Spanish.
Well, right, but the only difference is that these are actually Russian citizens. I mean, these are Russian
immigrants.
Well, I don't know if they're immigrants, but I think they're actually Russians that have lived there for years and years and years. These are actually Russian citizens. But anyway, but it's the same thing that happened in Kosovo. These were Albanians. Oh. I don't know if you knew that whole story with Kosovo. See, what happened is Albanians moved into Yugoslavia, that southern part, and they decided they wanted to be Albanian or have their own independence down there. And that's what started that whole conflict. And the Yugoslavia said, no, you're Serbian. You're going to be Serbian. And that's what started. Where the United States at that time said, no, these people need to be free. So we chose the side of the Kosovar independence. This time, we've chosen the opposite. This time, we decided to choose to go with Ukraine in opposition to the independence movement with the Donbass people. So it's just, we've just changed our mind on who we want to back this time.
Yeah.
And the whole reason, you know why? Because we decide now Putin is no longer, and you know why Putin is the enemy now? It's because he didn't like Obama. And Obama didn't like him.
Right.
That's what this is. This is what, see, these Democrats are so petty. Obama was dissed by Putin. Putin essentially thought of Obama as a lazy N-word.
Yeah.
No respect for Obama at all. Putin, at the same time, highly respected Donald Trump.
Yeah.
So, oh no, we can't have that.
Right.
So, because of that, Russia all of a sudden becomes the enemy. Because remember, under Obama initially, what did Hillary Clinton want to do? Hit the reset button.
Yeah.
Oh, we want to have this wonderful, great new relationship. But all of a sudden, mm-hmm. Putin says, I'm not having any relationship. You guys are fools.
Yeah.
You got this N-word running your country that's an idiot. And then the vice president is even worse.
Yep.
So I don't want to really, I'm not resetting anything with you. So this is a little background stuff that you're not going to hear anywhere else. I'm just going to tell you the truth. This is what it really is. Putin had no respect for Obama.
Yeah.
And less for Joe.
This kind of issue came up about 110, 120 years ago in the United States when we were opening the floodgates through Ellis Island. I mean, when my ancestors came in. And one of the people who spoke, what's today one of the most classic policy speeches, is the former president, Theodore Roosevelt.
Teddy.
Yeah. He talked about, you know, the hyphenated American. He says, everybody should be accepted as long as they come here to be American. There's no room for any flag than the American flag, for anything. Right. And he says, and treat them all, you know, with the respect and honor as a fellow American, but by God, be American. And assimilation is such an important factor here, because we did not accommodate in all of our government records for Swedish and German and Polish language versions like we do for Hispanic. You know, we did not make it easy for you to hang on to the old culture, the old language, the old loyalties. And I think that's a valid point here.
You know, it's funny that you just reminded me. I wrote a paper back in the late 90s. It's called The Ghost of Kosovo.
Oh, okay.
And what this paper was, I envisioned, this was the Clintons were in power at the time. And I made up this story of 2030 where, what's her name? What's the Clinton's daughter's name? Was it Chelsea?
Yeah.
Chelsea Clinton was the president of the United States.
Yes.
And that all of a sudden that Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, and Southern California decided they wanted to join Mexico. They wanted to be in it. Actually, it wasn't even there. Do you know what Aztlan is? Aztlan is this mythical, it's this land that these radical Mexican Americans have, and it
comes from the word Aztec, right?
Yeah, I think so. Aztlan. Mm-hmm. But anyway, and in their minds, parts of Texas, New Mexico goes all the way up into Colorado, in Nevada, and all. But
it used to
be Mexico, and they believe it actually still belongs to Mexico. Mm-hmm. And these are American people, but they feel they belong.
That's where their heart and loyalty is, isn't it?
Right, exactly. So anyway, in this thing was these people decide they're going to take it back for Mexico or make it its own land, Aztlan. And so this is what Chelsea Clinton is, because Bill was the president fighting, you know, with Kosovo to get their independence from Serbia.
Exactly.
And all of a sudden now it's happened here in America. And what's she going to do? How does she have a right now to say, no, you can't do that, when her father did the same thing in Kosovo? Because I was against us supporting Kosovo against Serbia because it was part of the country. It's like they just allowed them to take part of that country away.
Yeah.
And so now you know, and now we're doing the same thing. I mean, basically the same thing's happening in Ukraine,
yeah,
the Donbass. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, but that's what's happening. It's just a repeat once again, but what can we do? See, that's where we are in that situation. Now, we allowed Kosovo to break away and seek its independence,
yeah,
from Serbia.
Yeah.
But now all of a sudden we're telling the Donbass, you can't break away from Ukraine because we like Ukraine and we don't like Russia. Whereas in those days we didn't like Serbia,
mm-hmm,
but you know, so it's like we need to make up our mind, or better yet, we just need to stay out of it.
That's the thing.
That's
really
what we need to stay out of.
Because what our foreign policy, our State Department, or as Trump refers, our deep state department.
Our deep state department. That's good.
Yeah, is, you know, they will demonize somebody, an entity, in order to justify undermining that entity and trying to bring about really revolution. I mean, it is not by accident that Obama gets elected, and what do we see happen? 8 different countries fall through something called the Arab Spring. You got to know that Obama orchestrated that with Hillary Clinton, and especially in Libya. Hillary Clinton was all over that. I mean, she ordered the execution of
Gaddafi.
Yeah,
they are so stupid. I mean, stupid. They're so smart, they're stupid.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing.
Afterwards, Rand Paul is, you know, asking questions of Hillary Clinton before a Senate committee. And I think he's got evidence, not enough yet to make his case, that the reason why we lost Chris Smith, our ambassador, is we had a gun running operation where we were trying to buy back weapons and ship them to Syria because we were trying to overthrow Syria. That was Obama.
Yeah.
You know, Obama was overthrowing governments like crazy.
Yeah.
And that's why, you know, what's his name? The guy who wrote, did the 2 movies about Obama, said, you got to understand Obama, what motivates him. He is an anti-colonialist. His father was anti-colonialist. And he's driven that
Dinesh way. Dinesh D'Souza.
Yes, thank you. Dinesh D'Souza is like, that's really what's motivating him. And yeah, that's what you had in Kosovo.
Actually, he's beyond that. He's anti-American.
Well, he is,
right,
but yeah, under the same anti-colonialism.
Well, yeah.
Because his dad was anti-British colonialism.
Yeah, yeah.
But back in high school, I had a class of World War I and II, and I had the great luxury of having the foreign exchange student as my partner for these papers we had to do. She's from Sarajevo. And I get to talk to her, and it was wonderful, because that's where World War I started, is in her hometown. And she knew all of the generals, she knew all of the battles, she knew all of the towns where, you know, it made me look good. But we're talking about it, and, you know, because it's still a communist government at that time. And I talked to her about the basically dictator, Marshal Tito. She loves Marshal Tito. There isn't anything she wouldn't do for Marshal Tito. But the amazing thing about it is Tito... Yugoslavia means trans or greater Slavia.
Right.
And it was all these Slavic nations under one
together.
Country.
Right, yeah.
And it was really under the power of Tito.
Yeah.
And I mean, his people loved him.
Yeah.
Don't love the Yugo car, but, you know.
The Yugo.
Yeah, remember
the
that?
Yugo.
But his real, you know, high point was the 82 Olympics, 84 Winter Olympics. We're in Sarajevo. And here's the thing, when the wall fell and communism, country after country fell, it was inevitable. Yugoslavia would fall apart.
Yeah.
And really, I think ethnically...
Yeah, he was the glue. He
held it together. Kosovo, those people were Muslim, but keep in mind, it's not Muslim like you see Arab terrorist Muslim. My son with YWAM was up in the Caucasus Mountains, and they were Muslim. Now, Chechnya was just 100 miles from where my son was, and they were radicalized. But most of those Muslims there, the Kazakhs, in that, you know, pretty docile. Yeah. They were nominally Muslim. They didn't take it radically, and I think that's true. I think that was our justification.
Yeah, the farther west you go, the
we were less. Protecting their autonomy to worship. That was what was sold to us under Clinton, is they're being persecuted for their faith.
Yeah.
And if we're going to really believe in our creed and our mantra, then we have to respect those just as much as Christians who are being persecuted.
America has always just, you know, initially we started out to try to help. We helped in World War II. We saved Europe. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's legit. Okay, mm-hmm. We did that, and then we had to attack because Japan attacked us. Okay?
Right. We did not know that the Jews were being persecuted when we went to war. Or some may have.
Yeah,
but
some,
that wasn't our justification
right,
at the time.
Right. Right. But when we got attacked, then we okay, it's our, you know, and they were aligned with Japan, so we that gave us the signal to go.
Yeah.
But after that, you know, we started. You know, Korea, and then Vietnam, and on, you know, every time we feel like we're the white hat guys that show up every time.
Right. Well, we were stopping communism from taking over the whole world. That was our,
right,
the mantra.
Right. But we made so many mistakes. So for example, in South Africa, which I'm going to get into something here, in South Africa, when we went, apartheid, a lot of people think apartheid was the rule. But apartheid didn't come into South Africa until the late 40s. Mm-hmm. There was no apartheid until then. So, and for those that don't know what apartheid is, it basically said white people were at the top of the food chain. Then you had the mixed races and Asians. Anything but pure white was in this coloreds. They were coloreds. So it wasn't just mixed black and white. It was Asians, Indians, Hispanics, whatever. That was what was considered coloreds. And then you had blacks. So you had three distinct groups.
But
and with three distinct rights. Now, what happened then, the United States refused to help change that. Because we liked the gold in Africa, in South Africa. South Africa was rich in gold and minerals and things like that. So we were happy with that. And so we supported, we did not come against them. At the same time, Russia, or the communist bloc, decided they saw an inroad here. So they went and they supported the ANC, the African National Congress. They were into Namibia, the neighbors to the west, and a lot of different places in Africa, because America had its own situation with segregation and their own racial issues. So America was not the friend to the black man, and especially Africa. Mm-hmm. And this lasted all the way into the 80s. We didn't help Africa until, you know, in fact, we didn't help them until the communists, until the wall fell. And then all of a sudden, we started really getting involved, even in South Africa, changing that. But now, all of a sudden, to relive that to an extent, Putin has just forgiven all African debt. I don't know if you heard that. All of the African debt that these African nations have to Russia.
To Russia, yeah.
He's just.
Yeah, they owe way more to China.
Yeah.
And remember we had Eric in here from ORU who's from Seychelles. And or Mauritius, yes. And he said, yeah, China basically owns all of Africa now. I'm sorry, but yeah, Russia forgave the debt, was your point.
Forgets, right, right. There's still parts that Russia controls. China has a big chunk of it, but Russia, and Russia is China. It's like, Remember Risk, the group, the game Risk, mm-hmm. Stratego. Yeah, I'm reminded this world domination mm-hmm. kind of, but Russia now has really jumped into this, become the friend to Africa, while America is sitting there worried about Eastern Europe, mm-hmm. Russia and China mm-hmm. are all over the world, South America, Africa, India. What are we doing?
Yeah, and this is our foreign policy is so dictated by our big corporations. Bobby Kennedy Sr. had talked about that. He says, look, you know, Latin America is turning to communism because the United States is agreeing with their suppressors. He said, look what we're doing. And he mentions Venezuela and some others. And he said, where we're siding with the corporate interests over the rights of the people. They're oppressing their people, the big landowners and the big corporations.
Yeah, and I wouldn't even consider Russia necessarily that communist anymore. That's right, what's so weird.
Here's where I'm going with it is Nigeria. I had a friend who was over here going to college from Nigeria. Nigeria had just in the late 70s become oil rich. And he said, we had the thought that there might be oil. And we went to the Western oil corporations and asked them, and they all lied to us and said, no, there's no, don't even try to drill. You're not going to get anything in that. Because it would undermine the Western oil countries. And so what happened is the Russians then were invited in. They said, you were lied to by the Americans. They don't want you to get this wealth. And the Russians helped the Nigerians develop their oil. That's a good example of what you're talking about. Russian investment. Russia got something out of that deal. They deserve something out of it.
Sure.
And that's an example of Russian investment in Africa.
Yeah. And that brings me to something else. You know, I just wanted to mention that, though. Russia has forgiven the African debt. Mm-hmm. Putin has. And so, you know, Putin is the friend of Africa.
Yeah.
And China owns...
Sugar daddy.
And China owns half the airports in East Africa, you know, Kenya, Uganda, all this. So it's in South America, too. You know, they're really big there. But, you know, you were talking about... now, Taiwan, we just are sending $345 million in weapons to Taiwan.
Yeah.
Everyone gets weapons but us.
And the real money is going to the weapons manufacturers.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Weapons manufacturers. And we're behind. What was it they were saying? These Stinger missiles?
Mm-hmm.
We're 10 years behind on those.
Wow. Yeah.
And
I'm telling you, Mike Pence is so beholden to the military contractors. Right. Yeah. His whole campaign is all about kissing up to them. So what did Pence do? Went to Ukraine and said, every Christian ought to be behind this. And then remember, Tucker talked to him in Iowa a couple weeks ago.
See Tucker,
and he said, "I'm not. That's not my concern. That the American city is falling
really
apart.
Killed him. Stick a fork in him. He's done.
Walked it. He put his foot in his mouth.
Yeah.
I mean, Pence could not have looked worse.
Oh, yeah. He showed his behind. He really. You couldn't have done any worse.
That's just one example of how deep." The problem is with special interests, especially corporate interests, that has really competed with the mantra of the ideals which we want to believe that we're trying to spread around the world.
Yeah.
Being the world's policeman and all that. It's
In the meantime, Russia is becoming the sugar daddy. He's just going around to see this is what's crazy too. Mm-hmm. The United States is going to these corrupt Ukraine. Let's just face it, they're corrupt. Okay. It's a corrupt mm-hmm. country. Okay. It's corrupt. And it's because Biden owes them. He has to pay because they know where the bodies are buried. Mm-hmm. I mean, basically, they own him. China owns him. And so he owes them is actually more like it. But so he's busy with them. The Europeans are not doing a thing. We're spending all of our money propping up this one little country that keeps getting beat. I came across this little video from way back. It's kind of one of these little silent, and there was this little bitty guy getting beaten by this, you know, this big bruiser, and he's getting beat, and he keeps trying to get out, and there's a circle of guys around, and they get back in there, and they keep pushing him back, and he's just getting beat, and he gets knocked out, and they pick him up and push him back in there. And that's what I see with us in Europe, picking Ukraine, just, no, get back in there and fight.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're making money off this. We're going to keep sending you. Mm-hmm. We're making money by these corporations.
Yeah, it's just the American people want to always believe in whatever conflict, one of the people has a white hat. Yeah. You know, I want to talk about your South Africa situation. In fact, I was the former principal chief of the Cherokee tribe, Chad. Chad Smith. I run into him because it's a SRLC in 15, and I said, you know, I've kind of got a problem with you guys and the freedmen. And we got to talking. He said, Dave, he says, you go to Africa. They get it. They understand what it means to be part of the tribe.
Yeah.
And so I'm thinking about what you said in South Africa and how it developed over time. Think about Indian Territory, Oklahoma. We said to the tribes in southeastern United States, you want to stay autonomous, you got to go to Indian Territory. We've set it aside just for you, and you guys can run yourselves. But it was still under federal protector, right? Federal laws. So it wasn't really autonomy. And now we're having this battle with McGirt ruling being the latest volley in it is, okay, what is sovereignty? Because you hear the Cherokees talking about sovereignty all the time. You can't get them to define it, but it's this thing they want to believe they can have. And Soweto in South Africa had some autonomy. You could either live under this set of laws or that set of laws. And I can see the slippery slope of how it could turn into apartheid here. If the tribes get their ways, they're going to have to give up some American rights in order to have more tribal autonomy.
Yeah, that never should have happened. See the tribes, they had the opportunity. The Cherokee didn't need to take the terms they took. Mm-hmm. They could have done what the Chickasaw did. Mm-hmm. Where the Chickasaw basically said, okay, we're going to give them their, 50 acres and a mule.
Right. Whatever.
That was the...
Restitution.
Or reparations.
Or reparations, yeah.
Right. But they basically gave them their, I don't know, 20 acres, 50 acres, so many acres and a mule.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and they're done. Mm-hmm. So they didn't put them on rolls, anything. Mm-hmm. The Cherokee said, no, we'll make them... But because they didn't want to give them any land.
Right.
They didn't want to give up anything because they figured this is a better way to do it. Mm-hmm. But then they want to come back and renege on that. Mm-hmm. Renege. Mm-hmm. Not. I used to wonder if that was related. No. No, anyway. For those of you in Jinx, we'll talk about it later. No. No, anyway.
Renegotiate is what renege stands for. I know. Yeah.
Thank you. What? There you go. We talked about it now.
Despite what Sharpton wants us to think it means.
it's like with this guy in Washington, D.C., guy in trouble. He was like assistant to the mayor.
Yeah.
He was talking about the word niggardly.
Yeah.
But anyway, had nothing to do with the word. Yeah. But anyway, so I've forgotten what I. Oh yeah, the tribes. So the Cherokee, the Choctaw, the Creek. I think the Chickasaw are the only ones who took the deal to say, we're going to give you your 20 acres and a mule, 58, whatever, your land and your donkey or whatever. And they don't have a problem, you know, whereas the others, they did it and there's, oh man, oh, now how do we get out of this? Well, you can't do that. Now, what they could have done or should do maybe is call the black tribal members in and say, look, this is the deal way back, whatever. You know, let's renegotiate. You know, can we give you, you know, let's settle this up now. And then we got you off the rolls and we're done. Let's do a settlement and pay
you. Their negotiation was with the federal government. The federal government was claiming to speak on behalf of the blacks.
Yeah, that's true. But the freedmen, knowing my black folks, they said, don't speak for me. I can speak for myself. You know what I mean? So they could have, trust me, black people know how to speak for me. They could tell the government, stay out of my life. We can deal on this on our own. And they could have, and I guarantee you the federal government would have stayed out of it. They'd have gotten, not Sharpton, but what's this lawyer that does all of the trials? You know, he does all of the wrongful death cases. You know who I'm talking about?
If the glove don't fit.
That guy? No. He's dead, Sharpton. I mean, Johnny Cochran. Yeah.
Okay.
No, it's the new one, Crump.
Yeah.
Crump.
Benjamin Crump.
Crump will come in and he'd negotiate something.
Yeah.
And then the Cherokee said, yeah, sure. Right. But they should have gotten all of them together, put a prize out of it, boom, and you guys get this. But the Cherokee, you know, I guess they didn't want to do that, so now they got to deal with it.
Well, yeah.
It's a treaty. You signed a treaty with the United States. See, this is the argument I had with the guy that called me up that got mad because I said, you signed a treaty, you got to stick with it. And he said, oh, why? But I said, well, then let's let the U.S. government renege on theirs, and we'll just, you know, take back all that land. We'll just say you don't get your land anymore.
They wanted everybody else to be enforced on it except them.
Exactly.
But here's, Mark Wayne Mullen sat right here and talked to you and talked about how his tribe, the Cherokees, didn't keep any corporate tribal land. They distributed it, and his family got their land, okay? That happened before this whole Reconstruction, right after the Civil War. And so there really wasn't any land
left.
Yes.
Okay, but see, there's one. If you don't have land, there's something that black people want more than land, and that's paper. Or in today's digital currency, money.
Yeah, but
so no, seriously.
But it doesn't matter because this was before there was a Federal Reserve. There was just money was worth only what the bank.
I understand.
That printed
it. What I'm getting at is all they have to do is figure out an amount. What does it take to get you to let us get you off of our rolls?
I agree. But let me get back to what I was saying. So for the people of the tribe, the only thing would be now the people who got land given to them tax-free forever as long as they keep it. Like, Mullen doesn't pay property taxes on that land, you know, to this day. You and I have to. But rather than them give up some of their land, and I think it's the people who own the slaves should be giving the land, not the tribe. So here's my point. I think they said, yeah, let's just give them citizenship, even though that really didn't mean anything at the time. That was the easier thing to give away for free because they didn't have to give up land in order to.
Yeah, but no, I think there was still enough free land out there. For example, you had the township of Boley, Bird, all those black townships, all that.
Those were in other tribal territories. Boley was in Muscogee tribe.
Right, but I'm sure there's Cherokee land all around Tahlequah and all of these areas. There was enough land in Oklahoma to tell these people. There was land available. Let's put it that way. But I'm saying, but forget all that. Forget the past. Okay, I'm talking about now.
Okay.
All the Cherokee had to do is get together and say, come up with a number. Meet with the freedmen people. Come up it's a get the people together. And see, as lawyers, you have to make an offer. Mm-hmm. Now, the head of the group might say, well, we don't want to do that. But you have to make the offer to the people. Mm-hmm. And if the people say, well, wait a minute. Because, see, there's so much money coming in through the casinos, the Cherokee, mm-hmm. you know, the casinos they have and everything. There's so much money there that they could come up with a figure.
Oh, yeah. Today would be a whole different deal.
Well, that's what I'm talking about. Today is when we're dealing with it, when they're trying to kick them off the rolls. Mm-hmm. So that's the way you do it. Just figure out a number
and then
go to the freedmen and say, look, here's – pick a number.
Yeah.
And then we start negotiating, and then you've got them off the rolls, and now that they're off the rolls, now we can go forward. Because a lot of these freedmen, they're not, I mean, they're freedmen, but they're not making any money off being a freedman.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. They're just a freedman in name only, or a tribal member in name only, but they're probably not gaining any real privilege mm-hmm. as they would if somebody said, excuse me. We're going to give you 25 grand, 30, 50 grand, whatever the number may be, or we're going to give your kids scholarships.
Yeah. The only thing we have similar to that in the United States happens to be in Alaska. The state of Alaska chose to retain all mineral rights. And Sarah Palin was saying when she was running as vice president, so there's been years, not only did people not pay taxes, they all got a royalty check from the, the oil royalties that the petroleum companies.
See, as I understand, the Seminole in Florida, mm-hmm. they get money from the casinos. The profits from the casinos get shared among the tribal members.
Yeah. And what happens in most of these, like take the Cherokee band here in Oklahoma and others, and I'm not saying this specifically about them. Their propensity is to grow their tribal government and provide new services rather than just cutting a check. Because they're leftists. They believe in big government. They believe in powering and, picking winners and losers. That's really what's going on. Yeah. But this all came from, I was using an analogy of what you talk about, South Africa. It wasn't as, it's very hard for the American to truly understand the complexities of South Africa. Because South Africans say, we're trying to give these tribes more autonomy. But to give them autonomy, eventually they lose something in the bigger, over government. That's what the way it is explained to me. Maybe I was being lied to.
No, it's more complex than that. See, when I came back from Africa, this back in the mid-90s, I had a record company, and so we went to this gospel, this black gospel magazine publisher in Nashville. And I'm meeting with one of the writers in the publisher's office. I guess he was the assistant editor. I think he was the editor, and this lady was the, anyway, the editor found out I'd been in Africa, and he came out, oh, brother, hey, so you've been to Africa, huh? He says, tell me, brother, what's it like? What did we bring back? What did we bring back from Africa? What do we have from Africa? Mm-hmm. And I say, you want to know? He said, yeah. You really want to know? He said, yeah, tell me. I said, tribalism. You should have seen the guy instantly changed and got angry and turned around and walked away and slammed his door. He didn't want to hear it. Mm-hmm. But that's the problem. See, you still have... You have, I think, five different tribes there in South Africa, the Zulu, the Xhosa, the ones that click, mm-hmm. clicking ones, and there's, I think, three others. I can't remember what they're all called. But anyway, and what's interesting, a lot of people don't realize the Zulu are the biggest. That's the one that's the most well-known, mm-hmm. okay, the Zulu. Mm-hmm. But what people don't realize is that the Zulu are not indigenous to that area. And so people want to say, they always want to get upset about the white man coming, taking mm-hmm. land from the Zulu. No, The Zulu came to try to take it away from the white man. The white people were there before the Zulu.
Hmm.
The real indigenous people of South Africa were the Hottentots. Hmm. Didn't we talk about this before?
I think we did.
Chariot. Yeah. No, not Chariot. What is it? The Gods Must Be Crazy.
Yes, yes.
The movie Gods Must Be Crazy about the Bushmen.
Yes.
Which are the Hottentots is what they're really called, Hottentot people. Anyway, you know, where that Coke bottle falls from the sky and the guy worship, they're worshiping this Coke bottle or something. Mm-hmm. Anyway, but so the Hottentots were the original inhabitant, but then, of course, the Dutch came, settlers, and they started settling down there. And then the Zulu came down with Shaka Zulu, and killing tribes all the way down to the south. And then there were these other tribes that were migrating and all that. But anyway, so the tribalism in Africa is still strong. Mm-hmm. In fact, their political parties are generally made up of tribes.
Yeah.
And that's why you have these coups. That's why you keep having coups. People don't understand why these Africans keep having coups. I think South America is pretty similar too. Some of the situation there where, see, we don't have that in America. We don't have tribes. We had it in Europe, you know, in certain Scandinavia, where we had these tribes.
Right.
But the clans, you know, the parties formed along
the clan. Gangs.
Well, no. I'm talking about in the black community. That's what I was saying. Yeah, yeah. That's what we as black Americans brought from Africa.
Well, there are political gangs called Republicans and Democrats.
Well. Yeah, but it's different. No, it's different.
I understand. You just,
right.
The sectarian. Well,
let me finish my. Okay. So anyway, but so this whole argument about, you know, the in South Africa, what you were talking about here in South Africa, okay.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really buy it. To be honest with you, because the black Africans are as guilty as the white Africans.
Yes, I believe that.
All right, and what they have you been following the latest controversy in Florida about the history?
No.
Okay, the history books they're talking.
Oh, you're talking about what Kamala Harris said about, you know.
About, history.
The benefits of being on a plantation. Yes.
yeah. That black people, the skills they learned being on a plantation.
They did.
Okay, exactly. And so while slavery is not the prime example or the best way to learn your skills.
Mm-hmm.
It is a way to learn skills, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, if you are what they would call a house Negro.
Mm-hmm. That's the uppities, the privileged ones.
You learn to do what? You learn to cook.
Cook, to clean.
Clean.
Yes.
To
make
take
beds.
Care of things.
Empty the body pot.
you might have been the stable boy.
Yeah.
Take care of the horses, You groomed the horses, these things. Learned how to train the horses.
Yeah.
You did all these things.
you had more interaction with the master.
Right. Now, the field hands, that was tough. But a lot of those field Negroes ended up becoming foremen.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It reminds me, in fact, remember when I first came here in the 90s, you would have these... road crews in Tulsa and in Oklahoma, and you would have a white supervisor with some white employees and black ones and then a Mexican or two, and then all of a sudden you'd have more Mexicans working and then still a white foreman. Now when you go, you have a Mexican foreman and all Mexican workers, right?
Yep.
So it was those Mexicans learning those skills that ended up making them the foreman and having a total Hispanic road crew.
Right.
So that's what they were trying to say.
Yep.
Now, it might not have been said perfectly, but that's what they were getting at. And so in South Africa, for some reason, the transition from apartheid to Freiheit, which is freedom, Freiheit means freedom, and no longer this segregation, it wasn't handled properly.
Yeah.
It wasn't, properly, yeah. It wasn't handled in the best way.
Yeah.
They just, in one day, and see, the founders, man, boy, we're getting in all kinds of stuff today. The founders of our country, they saw that they could not take these slaves in 1776, and all of a sudden, somebody blows a whistle, you're free.
Yep.
Thousands of slaves that had no skill, no training, no understanding of how to handle their lives, and just set them free on the country. So what they envisioned and hoped for, that they were working towards that.
Mm-hmm.
And people don't understand that. People, and usually it's people that don't want to understand that. They don't want to understand that because they want to continue to hold that as this
power greed.
But as a guilt against somebody, so that, yeah, like you said, as leverage. They want to use it as leverage. Yeah.
People had something to gain by the black man being oppressed. They don't want to give that up.
Right.
You know, because
they can continue to use that guilt trip against you, against whites, to get what I want to get down the road. That's what they're doing.
Yeah.
And they've been these race pimps, as they call
it. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I do want to say.
And in South Africa, I'm going to real short. Okay. So what happened, all of a sudden, one day, Winnie Mandela.
Oh, yes.
Took over.
The patron saint of all that is holy.
Yeah. Yes. And knew nothing about running a country.
Yeah.
Had a bunch of people under her that knew nothing about running, streets, sanitation.
What was it government. Called with the tire full of fuel and they?
Oh, the I don't remember, but they burned, light them on fire.
Yeah, she had people actually burned to death.
Yeah,
and that was documented. I mean,
yeah,
and there again, this is the American simpleton. We want to believe that there's a good person in every struggle.
Yeah,
and Winnie Mandela was a just nasty.
Right. But a lot of it, but even without Winnie, there was nobody else there that had the skill and understanding on how to run a properly functioning society.
Yeah.
Zimbabwe.
Yeah, I was going to say. Rhodesia.
Their neighbor to the north.
Yes.
Same thing. What was their excuse? Kill all the white people and take their land.
Yes.
But what do they do with the land when they get it? They don't know how to handle
exactly.
it.
Exactly. A wealthy nation is now impoverished because of
this Mozambique. Kind of you just go through them. They don't know how to handle it, and so these fools in Florida who are trying to make something because and that curriculum was written by black people. They have black people on the board.
Okay, I just posted something 2 days ago. I mark this on your calendar. I agree with Kamala Harris. And this is what I agree with. Say no to any plantation that offers to provide your meals, your health care, your housing, your basic universal income, and family planning.
That's Kamala Harris said that?
No.
Oh.
She was criticizing that the plantation ever provided for it, but yet she insists the federal government can provide it. And I'm telling you, they're creating a plantation. Remember that the Asian guy in the last election for president was pushing universal basic income? That is pure communism.
Yeah.
Pure communism. They will offer you this, but you are now enslaved.
Yeah.
Now they have the power to control you. And they will withhold payment if you don't behave the way they want to.
Yep, that's exactly right.
Yeah.
Hey, man, we're going long. We were going short, and then we went long. Let me just a couple of things. You know who Will Hurd is? He's a former legislator from congressman from Texas.
Okay, yeah.
He was booed off the stage at the end of his speech up at this campaign event in Iowa.
Okay. Yeah. So he's a presidential candidate then.
Yeah, he's one of the
13.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And at the annual Lincoln dinner in Des Moines.
This was last night, Friday night. Yeah. Yep.
And here's what he said, and you'll understand why. Okay. The reason Donald Trump lost the election in 2020 is that he failed to grow the GOP brand in areas like women with college degree in the suburbs, black brown communities, and people under the age of 35. And you'll love this. He said, Donald Trump is not running for president to make America great again. Donald Trump is not running for president to represent the people that voted for him in 2016 and 20. Donald Trump is running to stay out of prison.
Right.
Can you believe that? To say that in a Republican gathering? Oh, man.
That is so gaslighting, because it's only because he's running again. Only because he's calling out the corruption that they're going after him. In fact, even I think MSNBC said, you know, this would probably all go away if he wasn't running for president again.
Oh, sure. Sure. It wouldn't. Yeah. Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, Forrest Gump's words were never more fitting.
Yeah.
Stupid is a stupid death.
That is revisionist history, folks. That is the kind of person you want, not even as dog catcher.
This is a guy I don't believe will be on the debate stage. I don't think he's qualified. I don't think he's met the criteria.
Yeah.
I don't even know what his deal is, why he would. I don't know why he would even make up something like that. He must. I don't know what his deal is, unless they threw him in there as a Bush guy. I don't know.
Yeah.
The Bush family may have put him up for the.
I'm sorry. What you do see, if you watch Ken Cuccinelli, he's the former AG from Virginia.
Yeah, I know who he is. Yeah.
And I've met him. We've talked to, you know, he's been involved with Freedom Works. And he's running a PAC, the Don't Back Down PAC, that was created just to get DeSantis elected.
Right, right.
And he all of a sudden is all over all media because he's desperate. And he's already now got these feelers out that maybe Glenn Youngkin, who you and I've met, you know, because he's helping Stitt, you know.
Yeah.
And by the way, as much as you and I respect Stitt is right now in for DeSantis.
Oh,
he's endorsed him.
I know.
And you already saw them together. You know, you were the MC of the event they were at, you know, here in Tulsa. Glenn Youngkin and Governor Stitt, you know, I don't know.
So Cuccinelli is switching.
Cuccinelli, they're talking about, okay, people have given a lot of money to your PAC because this guy's handling his millions and millions of dollars in a PAC. If DeSantis collapses, bows out, can you commit to us right now that you're not going to take that same PAC money and put it behind Glenn Youngkin? And he got mad. He did not. I did not come on the show to discuss this. He said. Okay. And but again, what happened here? You got a guy who's sitting on a lot of cash and controlling a lot of cash, and that's pretty heady. That's powerful, you know, and he does not want to make commitments, but he can't avoid it because he's desperate to try to reinvigorate DeSantis.
Yeah, I don't understand. Didn't he work for Trump at one point?
Cuccinelli? I don't think he actually did.
Okay.
No, he did. I think he ran for governor, didn't win. He was a pretty good attorney general.
Yeah,
you know? And but
yeah, I don't understand some of the people. Some of the people I understand. Some of the people.
Look, these guys are they love power. They love that money can translate to power, and they start these PACs to increase it because all of a sudden everybody wants to be your friend if they could get a little bit of money out of your PAC, and you become a kingmaker. It's a heady thing. By the way, we talked about early in the show about, you know, power corrupts. And that one other thing that you got to, that helped me explain, a blogger talked to me about it, about sex scandals and that. We were talking about the trappings of power and it attracts, you know, sexual attention and that. And he said, well, it's addiction. And I said, you mean a sex addiction? No, it's a gambling addiction. I said, gambling addiction? He said, a lot of those people are defying everything. They're gambling on whether they'll get caught. And when they get away with something, they want to try it again to see if they can pull it off. And he kind of explained it to me, and I've run it by a couple of people who've had careers in politics and watched a lot of people. He said, well, there is a certain aspect to that. Mm. People are just like, can we get away with it? And it's literally...
Catch me if you can.
Yeah, and I think Biden is probably an example of this. I mean, the guy will even admit to some of his crimes just to see, you know, hey... Can I admit to it and still get away with it?
Here's one example. President Biden took heat from critics after he finally acknowledged his seventh grandchild in a Friday night news dump.
You're kidding. He did?
Yeah. Weeks after his son Hunter settled his court battle with the mother of their four-year-old child, Navy Joan, mm-hmm. The president offered an exclusive statement to a magazine, to People, commenting on Navy's existence for the very first time after years of claiming he only had six grandchildren.
Right. Just a month ago, he said he had six grandchildren.
Our son Hunter and Navy's mother, London, are working together to foster a relationship that is in the best interest of their daughter, mm-hmm. preserving her privacy as much as possible going forward. Mm-hmm. This is not a political issue. It's a family matter. Jill and I only want the best for all of our children, including Navy, or all of our grandchildren, including Navy. Wow. But it says Biden was panned for Friday night news dump. Absolutely disgusting is what People magazine called it. So by doing
really?
It, yeah, People, they just let him have it.
People did?
Yeah. Yeah, they didn't. Yeah, they did not like the way he's done. So, and I'm glad somebody is finally.
I think really.
After denying it all this time and totally ignoring, now all of a sudden he's after they settled everything.
Yeah, I mean, I think in the next press conference, you've got to ask Biden to publicly, here and now, apologize to your granddaughter for not acknowledging her life and her worth, you know, and it really put him on the spot on that. Because this is something, Eddie, we can all, as decent human, you know, people come from families. This is decency.
Well, yeah, sure.
I mean, you're basically treating this little girl as a bastard and, you know, basically saying, you know, she doesn't count. There's no inheritance for her.
Would she be a bastard or a bastardette?
I don't know. I'm saying it in the generic sense.
I know, I'm just...
An illegitimate child.
I just throw stuff like that.
Right, and I'm just saying it.
No, I know what you mean.
I mean, this is the worst of society.
Yeah.
Is people who have offspring that they do not recognize and acknowledge.
Oh, I understand.
And they hide. You know.
Yeah, but he can't hide it, you know.
Oh, they've tried.
No, he didn't try to hide it. He just did not. You're on call denied, but what would you say? Just refused to acknowledge.
Well, Hunter denied being the father for a long time, and then a paternity test said.
Oh, well, yeah, that did, right.
Right.
But then Joe just decided to ignore. Ignore is a better. Yeah,
and I can't even, you know, there may be press statements where he actually agreed with Hunter and denied as well. But by not acknowledging, not even saying, and I may have a seventh grandchild, we'll see. Hunter denies it, but,
yeah.
You know, we'll see.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, but.
Now listen, I do want to say, and there's probably been hundreds, thousands, you know, of people, gold diggers, who try to claim, hey, I'm related to you, who aren't. Okay, so that does happen.
Oh, yeah.
So I can understand a person being reticent.
It was clear. Everybody knew that this was his grandchild.
At this point, yeah. Right. Now, right. But you have to understand, there are times when you have to not dignify a claim.
Right.
You know, because that's what they want.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah. So,
seeking the money. Hey, finally.
Yeah.
Do you have anything else?
A little bit. We've been talking about Gentner Drummond. Should he represent Stitt? Well, you know what? Evidently, Gentner's going to be representing the governor.
He won the case, or the...
I don't know what the process is, but I saw the headline say, yeah, Gentner is going to be representing.
But is he truly going to represent him, or is he going to represent the tribes?
I'll say this, Gentner. You're not going to be held to scrutiny this will be scrutiny like you've never had before. Everything you do. And Stitt can already appeal the outcome of this if he wants, just based on your public statements agreeing with his opponent, the plaintiffs. You know, right. So I don't know. We'll see. There's more.
Stitt's actually in a good,
yeah,
good spot.
I do want to take a little time. We got a couple of guests coming up next couple of weeks. We should say something about that too.
Please.
Okay. Next week, we have none other than Senator Nathan Dom scheduled come in. He not only has an illustrative career, finally finishing 12 years of being a state senator. This spring will be his last session. And then now is being the GOP state chairman. And we're going to talk about what's going on. In that, Nathan and I talked a little bit on, you know, he's developed somewhat of a friendship with Nigel Farage and may have some things to say about what's going on across the pond.
Maybe we'll get Nigel on.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'd like to do. Actually, I did, you know, float the idea of him inviting Nigel to do a GOP fundraiser gala. I said,
he can get Nigel to call and say, this is Nigel Farage. Whenever I'm in Oklahoma, I listen to Fresh Black Coffee.
And the funny thing is, when he had Nigel in town and Nathan was MC of that, I got the first question after the talk. Okay. And I said, Nigel, I just love your podcast on LBC. Are we going to hear you in podcast? He says, I will have an announcement.
He could at least say, I always enjoy my Fresh Black Coffee.
Yeah, there we go.
He's not talking about the show. He's just drinking coffee.
Well, the funny thing is, you know, he's with GB News. It's June fantastic. I mean, Pierce Morgan is up directly against him, and he's blowing away Pierce Morgan in the ratings over there. But anyway, Nigel had some things that. So we'll talk about that. And Nathan and his wife just had a baby.
Oh, congratulations.
I will let Nathan announce that stuff.
Well, you just already announced this.
But there's more to say about that. Oh, the
detail. There's details.
Yes.
All right. Hey, I think we'll finish with this.
Oh, and the week after.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Editor, I guess you would call him.
Pollster,
Sooner Politics.
No,
you're Sooner Poll. Sooner Politics.
Yeah, Sooner Poll.
Sooner Poll, yes.
Bill Shepard, none other.
Bill Shepard. It's funny, I used to enjoy hearing Bill and having him come on with Pat and myself.
Yeah.
On the Pat Campbell Show. And he was always very interesting, and I always enjoyed just hearing him explain his methodology. He didn't just talk about, well, we did this poll, and this is what we see or whatever. He would actually go into how and what about the polls. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because people would always try to attack his polling.
Right.
But... you know, until you actually look at and dig into it, it's hard to understand how intricate, how involved it is, and how it has evolved.
Yeah.
With cell phones and computers and everything that's going on, it's just it's not as easy as it used to be. And I want to get into all of that with Bill as well as what's going on. So in 2 weeks, we'll get into the most recent polls, but he's working on some brand new ones. So it's going to be an exciting show. So that'll be a couple of weeks from now.
I do want to say, what I especially love this, we're going to get an opportunity to interact with Bill in a way you normally don't see him with the media, because he's normally coming on presenting a poll. And part of the package deal when you hire a Sooner poll is he goes out and he makes himself available to answer the questions, defending the legitimacy of that poll. And that's where he's really focusing on the analytics and, you know, did he follow methodology and trying to defend all that. Now we get to see him step back a little bit and talk about, you know, his great legacy in Oklahoma. And probably some of his attitudes, some of his, you know he's got biases, you know he's got, you know, issues, you know, he's like anybody, you know.
Well, I don't want to get into that, because that's his personal thing.
It is. And I think he's honest about it. From what I've heard talking about, he's like, yeah, you know, I really would like to see this happen. You know, just like anybody. We're not normal people, us politically driven people, you know. We talk about this stuff, most people.
Yeah, but a pollster has to, you know, be pretty much non-biased.
In their work, right.
Right.
But they can still go home and talk, you know, to their buddies about their views.
But if they start publicly going out, and, you know, I prefer to try to stay away from that.
But so. I think there's certain virtues, certain things, you know, socially in the public arena that I think, you know, I think it's
so. As I said, Bill and I will be together. Dave will be.
Oh, I think I just got uninvited. But I'm just, you know, I don't think there's a better pollster, now I'm kissing up, right? I'm trying to get back in. I don't think there's anybody with a greater legacy for the kind of work he does. And it's very important work.
No, it has. And it's funny because, like I said, years ago, you know, with Pat, I know people would often call, they would always second guess Bill's polls and so
forth. If they don't like what it says.
Yeah, well, right.
It's usually it.
And there were a couple of times where, you know, he may be off by a few points or so, but everybody's off. And for example, one of the ones I remember when I picked Donald Trump to win in 2016, and everybody, I mean, you know, Pat's go-to used to be the betting odds. Remember you can actually bet, I don't know if you knew this, you can bet on candidates.
Yeah.
In elections. Mm-hmm. And so you can put $100 down, and Hillary was like 73-27, you know, for Hillary. And so Pat was, Trump doesn't stand a chance. And I was, oh, no, he's going to win, you know. And I was using different methodology. I'm not going to reveal how I knew he was going to win, but I really knew it, but I won't say I cheated, but I had some different things I was using. Anyway, and so that morning, the betting odds were still there, but by about 6 o'clock in the evening, they had kind of evened out, and by like 7:30, all of a sudden, it switched. All of a sudden, it was 70 for Trump and about 30 for Hillary, and then it was 90, and it was over, you know.
Yeah.
You could tell. So, but it was kind of interesting, but so that came out of nowhere. I mean, really, because Hillary was supposed to beat him like a drum.
Oh, I agree.
At the time. And things like that happen. Those are called anomalies. And so Trump beating Hillary back in 2016 was really, you know, a surprise.
Yeah.
But I want to get into, and remember this, if you will, Dave, we need to find out about the gubernatorial, our Oklahoma
elections.
That's exactly elections.
What I wanted to get with
because
it.
To find out how he had it and how, you know, people were so wrong. Yeah,
everybody had both Walters and Stitt losing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, this is something Bill, I've seen him do in the past, and he does it very well, is that when he gets it wrong, he studies, okay, what did I miss? What showed up as a bigger factor than I equated in my poll?
Right.
You know, you want to look at your sampling, you know, rural versus urban, you know, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And age demographics. One of them he got dead on actually was the 788. You know, and... anyway, you know, so there's times you get it right and there's times you're just going to get it wrong. Yeah. And you know, he's humble enough that he's, yeah, I missed this.
I think he's a great guy and he's definitely worth following.
Yep.
Hey, in closing, I want to say we lost a musical great. It's funny, most of you won't even know who it is. Randy Meisner. See? Randy Meisner.
Right over my head.
You won't know this, but he's a co-founder of the Eagles.
Oh.
Yeah, he was originally with the group Poco.
Okay.
That's how he started. Mm-hmm. And then he joined the Eagles, and then he went solo. He went on his own.
Yeah, the Eagles were a super group.
Yeah. Yeah.
Joe Walsh, I mean, right. All
but Joe it. Came, actually, Joe actually replaced Randy.
Yeah, and Joe was actually probably one of the last supergroup members. I mean, right. He came later.
Right.
They were already famous before him.
Right.
But they had some country western, actually, Finley, who's the guy?
Don Finley.
Don Finley, yeah, wasn't he one
I think
of
it was them? Don Finley. It's something Finley, but I know what you're talking about, yeah.
But yeah, there were just, these guys all
Fender.
Had.
Fender.
They all had solo, like Joe Walsh kept doing solo projects while doing that. You couldn't get better than being invited to join the Eagles.
Yeah, well, actually, Joe was with James Gang, wasn't he? I think that's what his original band was.
Yeah.
He was from the James Gang. But no, I mean, there was some, the Eagles, they are great, great musicians before and after. In fact, did you know that originally, the original Eagles band, they were Jackson Brown's band.
Oh.
Yeah. They toured they toured with Jackson Brown as his band and Linda Ronstadt.
Okay. Yeah. So it's kind of one of those studio bands.
But they actually toured. They were...
Yeah. Like, I told you one time we were leaving the show and we were out in the parking lot that I was up at Cornerstone Music Festival and I saw this billing for some group called Koinonia.
Oh, yeah.
It was Hadley Hawkinsmith and Harlan Rogers, you know, who were like studio musicians
Fletch
for all.
Wiley,
all these great albums you heard.
Billy Maxwell.
They were the studio band, you know, that the record label always had, you know, for their best artists. And these guys hit the road for some of these select things like Cornerstone. And, you know, and the funny thing is, I didn't go see them. And I'm like, oh, this would have been great.
You know where they... they met at North Texas State.
Is that right?
Yeah, the 1 o'clock jazz band, they call it.
Sherman? In Sherman, Texas?
No, Denton.
Denton, that's where it is, yeah.
And the 1 o'clock lab band. And then they became a Christian band.
Yeah.
Named Sunlight.
Were they in Carmichael's label? Light Records.
Yeah, they were actually, before that, they were Andre Crouch's band.
Right.
They were Andre Crouch's backup band.
Well, he was Ralph Carmichael. This is like mid-70s.
Right.
Before Word and Sparrow ever got to be big labels.
Right.
There was Light Records, yeah.
They became Andre Crouch's band. Then they released their own. They had, I think, two albums.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I still have their first album. Yeah. And then they all... split and end up becoming studio musicians.
Mm-hmm.
Like Hadley, if you go back, Hadley Hawkinsmith what's the keyboard player? Anyway, a bunch of them, they're on all these Hollywood secular artists.
Right, because Ralph Carmichael studio. Was very connected with Hollywood.
Yeah, all these studio, they became big-time studio musicians.
Yes. Yeah.
And Billy Maxwell as well, but... Yeah, they became very famous, and that's when they then formed Koinonia.
Yep.
And they were known as, and they added Alex Acuna,
mm-hmm.
the percussionist.
And yeah.
Sorry, we're getting off in this little world. Yeah. Sorry. Hey, everybody, we better wrap this up. I just want to say, yeah, Eagles co-founder Randy Meisner passed away. He had chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. He died Wednesday. So I don't have any Eagles music to play, or Poco, who's my favorite band, Poco.
Yeah.
And
we got about 5 weeks to go before college football starts.
That's a piece of news I didn't even mention here. That Colorado.
We started out there. We did, yeah. So we got Colorado.
Start all over.
And I had done some studying on it. I was surprised when this happened. They were supposed to wait until a media deal, because the Pac-12 commissioner was working on behalf of all these schools to get a media deal that they would all sign to. Evidently, in those conversations, the regions of Colorado just saw it. Their chances of anything approaching a decent media deal.
Pac-12. The Pac-12 media deal.
Yeah.
The Big 12 got there.
Yes, right. The Pac-12 media deal. And so, well, this is a battle. Why wait? And because, I mean, here's the thing. The Big 12 had said they had picked four teams, Colorado, Utah, Arizona, and Arizona State. Right. This is the four corners, they call them. It's actually three, because they aren't picking any New Mexico schools. But anyway, the Big 12 has said our contingency, if we don't get these four, is to pick UConn, Connecticut, University of Connecticut. And I think Colorado was kind of like, we better take the deal before it gets pulled, because I think UConn would grab the deal.
Yeah.
Because the Big 12 is reaching up into that area with already West Virginia and Cincinnati.
Yeah, but people don't understand, Oklahoma is so football-oriented, mm-hmm. but what people don't understand, UConn is basketball.
Oh, they are the king. Yeah.
Cincinnati, basketball.
Oh, huge.
Arizona.
Yeah.
Basketball. So the Big 12 is looking beyond just football.
Right. But now, here lately, Cincinnati, as dominant as they've always been in basketball, is they become a football powerhouse.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, Houston, both football and basketball.
Right. They've been consistent. In fact, this year, they went to the national championship mm-hmm. in Houston in basketball.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
West Virginia is a good basketball school.
Right.
And football.
Yeah.
So.
If they keep their coach, the former Cincinnati guy, he evidently is fighting to get his job back after a DUI. Huggins. And I don't know if he's going
to. Yeah. Maybe he needs to talk to you and just start smoking dope.
You know, I don't know. But you realize from where we were 2 years ago, when the big announcement of OU and Texas leaving, and everybody's like, there's the death of the Big 12. Big 12 is no longer. It goes the way of the Southwest Conference and that. And I had said at the time, all we need to do is pick these four schools. And they did. They picked the four schools that I said, you know, Central Florida, you know, Cincinnati, Houston, and then BYU. And now all of a sudden, it's looking like brilliance. The Big 12 is really looking good.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, it's funny, these sports pundits, some of them are trying to talk it down, but for some reason, people don't like the Big 12. And I think it's this bias against Middle America.
Yes!
They just don't like Middle America, and they're trying to put it down.
Yeah.
And they're so into the Big 10 and the SEC You know, and then of course they're rooting for the Pac-12 because LA but I mean when USC and UCLA, that really gummed up the works. I think that was wrong. I think they did themselves and the Pac-12 mm-hmm. a disservice. Mm-hmm. I think they would have been better merging with the Big 12.
Yeah.
Or anybody. I mean, or bring in a couple of Big 12 teams to the Pac-12.
Yeah.
They could have done that. They could have taken mm-hmm. Texas Tech and OSU, let's say, and brought them over there. to make them a 14, and maybe a couple other teams, Baylor and Kansas State or something. I mean, you pick two, all right, and then make it a 16. But they could have made the Pac-12 big, but they didn't. You know, they chose not to. They decided to join the Big Ten, which is really weird to me that they would choose the Big Ten.
I have to tell you, I disagree with the whole attitude of having more than 12 teams in a conference. You weaken it, just like the WAC. They went to 16 teams and then collapsed.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, that and the NIL are two of the things that I think in the end, both of those are going to work against football, college.
Actually,
football.
Congress is now working on some laws to rein in NIL.
Yeah, they need to. Somebody needs to do something.
That's happening. And I talked to some people who are big Nebraska fans. And I think of, you talk about a university that made a mistake in changing conferences. I can't think of a worse mistake than Nebraska making. But I asked these people, it was Christmas Day. I'm talking to them at the up in Minneapolis, they were heading home. And I said, is there any chance you guys come back, to the Big 12? No, never.
Yeah, Arkansas is another one. They should have never left the Southwest Conference.
Right. But that Southwest Conference did collapse. And I think part of
it didn't really collapse. It just became the Big 12.
Sort of. Yeah. I mean, yeah, those Texas schools came over. That's when it collapsed, is when those teams came to the Big 12.
Right. But if Arkansas had stayed, it would have still become the Big 12.
Yeah.
We probably just wouldn't have taken Iowa State or something.
Actually, we used to be called the Big 8.
Yeah, the Big 8. Right.
Yeah. And,
but, so, I mean, there's so many of these, like, for example, several teams. I don't think A&M should have gone. I don't think A&M has always thought more highly of themselves than they are. I mean, always.
They had one good year. Little Johnny, remember? The quarterback.
Well, yeah.
Flash in the pan.
But I think Arkansas shouldn't have gone. Missouri is another one that doesn't belong over there.
That's another good argument of a mistaken move. And Colorado, I think, is a mistaken move. All three of them. I have not seen them elevate their success in leaving the Big 12.
Right.
Missouri, Nebraska, or Colorado.
Colorado, right.
But
now here's the thing, and this is because of ESPN. Mm-hmm. The money.
Yeah, and ESPN is a partner with the SEC.
Right. That's why they won't come back. Mm-hmm. Now, where whoever that told you that Nebraska will never come back, mm-hmm. and this other writer that I just read mm-hmm. talking about how he thinks Colorado made a bad move and this isn't good, and all of these where they may eat their words is if Fox mm-hmm. ends up getting a bigger audience mm-hmm. than ESPN.
Yes.
Now, ESPN is bleeding money.
Okay, yes.
They're trying to find new buyers.
Yeah, they're owned by Disney.
Right, exactly.
But by the way, just to put that in perspective, what I heard last Christmas saying they'll never come back, that was before UCLA and USC came over to the Big Ten. Because here's the deal. Big Ten, which was 14 teams, right. had split into an East and West division. And Michigan and Ohio State, the two perennial powerhouses, were both in the East.
Right.
So you knew they were one of those two was going to win the East. And everybody else had a shot at the West. Wisconsin was powerful. Minnesota wanted to be Iowa, but Nebraska always felt like they had a shot to win that division because they could compete with it. It wasn't as strong. Now that they have to compete with UCLA and USC, does Nebraska really want to have to play the bridesmaid constantly?
Yeah.
And I think, the chance to rebuild that legacy, with Oklahoma. Well, see, Oklahoma's gone now. You don't have that big rivalry. But get back in the Big 12 and play the Kansas and Iowa State, and those schools. in Colorado. To me,
yeah, unless you know, if the Big 12, who they really, you know, there's not room now. You know, they now that we're at what we're back to 12, so what we need? No, actually, we're 13 now, aren't we?
Yes.
So those other schools better get on it quick. You know, I think Arizona State, we got room for one more to get to 16.
Yeah.
Utah would be ideal if Utah would come.
I think you're right.
That's who they
really having Brigham Young in there, you give a gift. Brigham Young now has that in-state rivalry that's part of the
conference.
Well,
right, but I think they said that Utah didn't really want to play Brigham Young.
Oh, okay.
Every year. I think that's one of the drawbacks. That's one of the drawbacks. Yeah. But I don't know why. I mean, that would be just a natural in-state rivalry every year. You would think they would want it.
Yeah. Of those
like
three.
Like OSU wants to keep playing OU. I mean, that's what you know.
Right. Somewhere. I think of all those three teams still out there, Utah, Arizona State, the biggest prize is getting Arizona. You know, they're a powerhouse in so many sports.
Well, the basketball in particular. Yes. Yeah, that's right.
And, they haven't been so great in football, but they have the trappings to be.
Right.
And you're becoming a little bit bigger market. Phoenix is getting big and stuff. So you're always looking at that. And here's the thing, Eddie. It's about money. And that's the sad thing. These border regions, it isn't about rivalries to them.
You know,
it's about money.
That's true that you mentioned that really Utah has been good at football in the past several years. Mm-hmm. But it's just not that big of a market as compared to what Phoenix can be. The whole Phoenix, Tempe, that whole.
Right, and remember the first TV deal once the Supreme Court ruled NCAA doesn't get to control media for their teams? The first team to get a TV deal was Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. They had the strength of a national following because there's Catholics all over the nation. Well, there aren't as many Mormons, but that was part of the draw of grabbing Brigham Young. Because you got the attention. It's all about, you know, for the coach, it's about what helps recruiting.
Right.
You know, and that's why that was the only reason I said UCF, University of Central Florida. I was talking to Todd Graham, the former TU coach, went to Arizona State, and he said, the big states for recruiting in football, of course, is Texas and Florida, California, and Ohio. Those are the four areas where you get the highest level of performance in high school football. And that's really where you want to have a presence. And that's why Barry Switzer always made sure we had that Texas OU game at the Cotton Bowl. Because what it did for our recruiting in Texas. Because we would beat Texas with Texas players.
We
do it all the time. I mean, look at all of our Heisman quarterbacks all came out of Texas. Well, Bradford did, and he was Oklahoma City boy. But, you know, I'm just saying there's great football players there, and you got to be looking at that. That's the part the coach wants. The Board of Regents wants, so what's the best money deal?
Yeah.
So
yeah, it's always that. Yeah. Always. Hey, we better wrap up.
Alrighty.
This is our longest show ever.
Yeah.
We set a new record.
Yeah.
Hey, thank you, everybody. By the way, I want to mention Low T Center.
Yes.
Low T Centers of America.
Yes.
I'm a weekly patient.
Yep.
Patron. Customer. And thankful for it.
Yeah.
And anyway, hey, no, seriously, men, if you're over 30, you may want to give them a visit on South Memorial.
It makes you more pleasant to be around, too.
Yeah, yes.
And that's, Eddie,
that's
I don't know.
That's not what my wife thinks. But
for some of us, it worked better than others.
Yes. But no, seriously, but give the Low T Centers of America down in South Tulsa, off of Memorial, right behind Hideaway Pizza, and it's done wonders for me. Like I said, my total health, they're very good. So,
you
but
betcha.
Anyway, hey guys, we've enjoyed it. Hope you do too. And we will, Lord willing, and the creek don't dry, talk to you next week. Man,
still got to figure out how we. I hopefully.
Oh, your music.
Your patch cord will work, hopefully, but.
Oh, for the, for him.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah. No,
so, I don't see.
Yeah.
I don't see it actually sending sound back out.
Oh no, I know it works because I watched the video and I watch it again on YouTube.
Oh, it does, because that's how we get sound out. That goes to our camera, so of course it does.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah, so
so that part does work both ways. So yeah. Good.
So we'll test it though. We'll test it.
Yeah, that'd be good.
I'm fading it out.